The past 10 days, I've wanted to stick my head in an oven. But if I wait another week, I'm pretty sure Stephen Bannon will do it for me. Yeah, I'm glad my grandfather isn't alive to see Trump in the White House. Because my grandfather was a fucking asshole who would have probably voted for Trump. You okay? You all right? We're going to start the show. Take deep breaths. Come on, take deep breaths. It's going to be okay. Make soup. Go to fivecalls.org. Anxiety is anger turned inward. It's okay to be angry. Don't take it out on yourself. Go to fivecalls.org. Are you eating okay? Are you eating the right food? Are you going for walks? Are you turning off your social media? Have you turned off the TV? Are you listening to music? Are you hanging out with friends? You can't have the TV going all day. Now, here's an idea. Put on your headset. Go do the dishes. I'll wait. Do a wash. Go do the wash you're supposed to do. Put on your sneakers. Go for a walk. Go for a drive. Just don't fill up at ExxonMobil. Just, you know, because... But we're not going to talk about that right now. Take deep breaths. We're going to start the show, okay? Everybody okay? We got through 9/11. We've been here before. We're stopping Trump in his tracks. We're fighting him on day one. We are. But you got to stay focused, okay? Fivecalls.org. It's going to be okay. Don't be angry at yourself. He lost the popular vote by 3 million. We didn't do this. We didn't want this. We have institutions, but we have to hold them accountable. Subscribe to the New York Times. Support real journalism with your money. Don't fill up at ExxonMobil. Go to fivecalls.org. They will give you a script. You will be told which senator or congressperson to call. 5 minutes. 5 minutes a day, five calls. Channel your anger productively and protect yourself. Take deep breaths. Right? Don't eat garbage. Make soup and go for a walk. Get a broom, get a vacuum cleaner. Start sweeping. Clean your space. Make soup. All right. Okay. Now we're going to start the show. Maybe Donald Trump would consider hanging himself to heighten my orgasm. Folks, American decency must be spinning in its grave right now. This travel ban, I'll tell you what. We'll give immigrants that test to determine whether or not they're Christian just as soon as Donald Trump can pass it. That is why, until Donald Trump is impeached, I, David Feldman, self-identify as Muslim. I am a Muslim now because religion is fluid. Yes, religion is fluid, much like Trump's face after the Russian hooker has finished urinating on it. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, DavidFeldmanShow.com. Please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, Do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. We have a lot of show today, but there's a lot of news going on. Tina Dupuy, she just finished up a job working as communications director for a progressive congressman who didn't get reelected. We're not going to mention his name, but Tina has been published in The Atlantic, The LA Times. She's a syndicated columnist. She's also a comedian, a comic. She's a comic. Terrific insight into what they're thinking up on the Hill and why you should be calling your congressman and senator and faxing them. Go to 5calls.org, the number 5calls.org. They will tell you who to call and what to say. It's so simple. 5 minutes, 5 calls every day. Nick Mullen is back. I didn't have enough time for him last week, and he was kind enough to return and talk about freedom of speech with me. An old friend of mine from Fox News Radio, comedian Barry Weintraub, and I discuss how we got here via talk radio. What happened to radio? Barry Weintraub is in the trenches over at Fox News Radio. He tells us why we are where we are and the dangers of radio, why the richest 1% are so afraid of radio, because it's the most powerful medium out there. It's more powerful than writing. It's more powerful than television. The richest 1% in America controls radio because we get inside your head. Radio is dangerous. Barry Weintraub joins us. Comedian PJ Landers. Tamer Kattan. He's a brilliant comedian. He also joins us. Now, originally, this show was going to be a roundtable, but we had technical difficulties. Yeah. So we staggered the guests. It's all one-on-one today. You'll hear the show as is. It's a little sloppy, but I think we stumbled into another way of doing this show. You know, maybe roundtables right now are not the way to do this show. Maybe it's just going one-on-one with our guests. The point I'm making is that was our Apollo 13 moment. I always talk about this on the show. We remember Apollo 11, then we remember Apollo 13. Apollo 13 was our greatest moment as Americans because we brought them home. It was a crisis and we brought them home. And that's what's going on right now in the United States. We have a crisis. Donald Trump. It's going to be America's greatest moment. This is the opportunity for all of us to realize that civics is important, that we have to pay attention to what's going on in Washington, D.C., that we need the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Economist, the Nation magazine, the Guardian. We need real radio. We need real intellectuals. We can't allow alternative facts to turn this country into a fascist state. This is our moment. This is when we wake up. Well, we were supposed to post my interview with Steve Young, America's favorite comedy writer, but due to the events, due to the Muslim ban, we can't have him on the show. He's not Muslim, although I'm sure he would convert with me. I believe Steve converted to Judaism. One of the smartest people I know, Steve Young. I don't know why he would convert to Judaism, but I think I know why. But because of the Muslim ban, we're pushing him back to Friday. We drop these shows Tuesdays and Fridays. We're being very rigid about this now, thanks to my producer, Alex Brazell. He says consistency is the key to what you owe your audience. So every Tuesday and every Friday, we drop a show. Steve Young will be on Friday's show. I plug his gig that is coming up this week on Friday's show, so it's too late. But his show is sold out, so it doesn't matter. All right, here's a gig that I want to plug. My good friend, Scott Rogowski, Running Late, is doing his live show in Los Angeles. And I have listeners in Los Angeles. He is at the Virgil in Los Angeles. And these are the dates. On February 3rd, Scott Rogowski's Running Late show will be at the Virgil with Reggie Watts and the Sklar Brothers. That is great. Then he has a show February 4th at the Virgil with Rebecca Sugar. February 10th at the Virgil, Dana Gould, Rory Scovel. February 11th, Tom Middleditch and Joe Manganiello. And February 12th at the Virgil, Weird Al Andy Kindler, Nikki Glaser at the Virgil, February 12th, 2017. That is a Scott Rogowski show, Running Late, which he does with Marty. It's my favorite show. I wish that's one reason to go back to Los Angeles just to see that. So go catch that. That's some great stuff. I know we have Trump supporters listening to my show. I'm not trying to make you feel stupid. I'm just trying to make you feel uneducated. That's all. I want you to feel uneducated. If you didn't graduate from high school, if you didn't go to college, don't feel stupid. Feel uneducated. I cannot help it if you didn't go to high school. I cannot help it if you dropped out of high school. I cannot help it if you weren't lucky enough, privileged enough to go to college. I went to college because I grew up upper middle class through no fault of my own, and I was forced to go to college. And when I got to college, I was unprepared, and I became an alcoholic and a pothead. And it took me 6 years to get through college. I was dropping in and dropping out. But one thing I remembered from college is I'm an idiot, and it's stuck with me forever. And I'm constantly trying to make up for the lost time in college, drinking and smoking and not going to class. So I've spent every day since I've been sober apologizing to my parents by trying to learn what I should have learned in college. I recognize that I'm uneducated. I recognize that I'm stupid. I recognize that, yes, I have a college degree, but it's bogus because I learned how to write papers without even reading a book, and I got by on my BS abilities. But I know that I'm stupid, and I know that I'm uneducated. So I surround myself with people who can teach me. Surround yourself with people who are better than you, occasionally better than you. Surround yourself with people who know more than you do. Trump supporters don't do that because Trump won't do that. He surrounds himself with sycophants. He surrounds himself with Eric, Don Jr., Ivanka, and that idiot Jared Kushner, who I'll get to in a second. Don't resent somebody because they know something you don't know. Learn from them. Go back to what you were taught in elementary school. Your teacher knows something, so shut up, listen, and learn. Behave. Play well with others. Do everything you were taught in first grade, which is the complete opposite of everything Donald Trump represents. And the reason you voted for Trump, Trump supporters, is he doesn't make you feel stupid. When did having a lack of education become something to celebrate in this country? Probably under George W. Bush, who had to hide his Harvard MBA and his Yale diploma with a Texas drawl, that Texas twang, because people were threatened by Al Gore. What's wrong with being educated? We're here to educate you because I'm stupid. I'm an idiot. I'm a fraud. It's okay to be stupid and uneducated as long as you're willing to shut up and listen. And that's the problem with me on this show. I talk too much. I know that. I'm trying to get better at it. So now we're banning Muslims, right? We're going into the second week. Call your congressman, peacefully protest, show up. It drives Trump and Bannon crazy. Trump is trying to ban Muslim refugees. But if those Muslim refugees, by the way, if they can somehow make it in here, they are free to go buy an assault weapon, right? No problem buying an assault weapon. We need to ban assault weapons, not Muslims. If you're on the no-fly zone in this country, you can still buy an assault weapon in America because the NRA is controlled by gun makers. Gun makers make money by killing you. Stephen James, who listens to my show, he made a meme for me. This is what he wrote, and he made it in a beautiful JPEG that I will post on Facebook and Twitter and over at my website. This is what the meme says. Since 1995, there have been 3,503 Americans killed by all terrorist attacks. Many of those dead were killed by Catholic and Christian terrorists. Since 1995, there have been over 256,000, wow, gun homicides. Let me read that again. Since 1995, there have been over 256,000 gun homicides. This number does not reflect the many thousands of self-inflicted gunshot suicides. Wow. Muslims are not the problem. If we are banning what threatens Americans, ban guns, not Muslims. Thank you, Stephen James. And I will post that, with his permission, to my website, and I will post it on Twitter and Facebook. Well, last week, Trump removed the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the director of national intelligence from the National Security Council. That is not a congressionally approved part of the White House. And he replaced these people with President Steve Bannon. Howie Klein, who's on the show all the time, says if you want to get Steve Bannon kicked out of the White House, always refer to him as President Steve Bannon, because Trump will fire him because of his ego. By the way, Dr. Joseph Goebbels, who was the minister of propaganda for Adolf Hitler, was kind of brilliant. The way that the Nazis went after their powerful opponents, publishers, industrialists, Jews who held sway in the early years of Nazi Germany. Dr. Joseph Goebbels taught the Nazis not to attack these powerful people. He taught them to cut them off at their knees so they're alone and isolated. Don't go after the powerful people. Go after their underlings so that it gums up the works. Kind of genius. So you had these powerful industrialists and writers and bankers who didn't know that they were alone until it was too late. Genius. So my advice to people who want to save our republic is, yeah, it's good to attack Trump, but go after Steve Bannon. Start calling him President Steve Bannon. Start going after Ivanka. Go after Jared Kushner. Go after Kellyanne Conway. Too easy to go after Kellyanne Conway, but start cutting Trump off at the knees. So one day he just fires all these people because he's, you know, impulsive. He's prone to paranoia, or ruled by paranoia. And in 6 months, he's going to be all alone in the White House. Rince Priebus will be gone. They'll all be gone because he's insane. And he'll just be completely isolated. So it's important to go after Trump, but take a tip from your good friend, Dr. Joseph Goebbels. I'm serious here. I'm being absolutely serious. You got to take a page from the Dr. Joseph Goebbels playbook. Start going after President Bannon. That way, Trump will be all alone in the White House like Nixon, just on his knees praying, talking to the portraits of the presidents like Richard Nixon. That's what we have to do. We can get we can impeach Trump, or we can get him to resign. We really can. You baby boomers, you know what I'm talking about, right? Remember how rock hard you felt when Nixon resigned? You won't need Cialis anymore. Trust me. When Trump goes, it's going to be, yeah, high school wood, as my friend Ray James calls it. Isn't that a great term? High school wood. Well, Steve Bannon now is going to be in the National Security Council. He is a chief strategist in the White House. He is going to be part of the National Security Council. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff won't be there. The director of national intelligence will not be there. Steve Bannon, President Steve Bannon, will be there. He has no government experience until now. He's never worked in intelligence. He's had no high-level military experience. He was in the Navy, and he ran the alt-right propaganda outlet known as Breitbart News. Their job is to push white nationalist, anti-Jew, anti-Arab propaganda. What's dangerous about this is it is the National Security Council, not the Pentagon, that authorizes all those secret targeted killings of American citizens overseas without due process. As Jim Earle calls it, the drone incinerations that go on, that comes out of the National Security Council. So Steve Bannon is going to be advising Trump in the National Security Council. We won't have the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff or the director of national intelligence. Rince Priebus said on the Sunday shows, well, they'll be invited, you know, if they want to come, but they don't sit on the National Security Council. So who is Steve Bannon? Well, you all know. I don't have to remind you who Steve Bannon is. He is a racist and an anti-Semite. In the Washington Post, it was reported that Steve Bannon is against foreign students who are studying here in America. He's against foreign students staying here after they get their degree. He wants them to go back to where they came from because he thinks it's wrong when, quote, two-thirds or three-quarters of the CEOs in Silicon Valley are from South Asia or from Asia. He says Asians should not be running Silicon Valley. Yeah, doesn't like Asians, and he doesn't like Jews. And what's the stereotype? What's the vicious stereotype about Asians and Jews? That they're smart, that they're good at math, right? A white nationalist like Steve Bannon would propagate these kind of stereotypes that actually hurt Jews and actually hurt Asians because it creates jealousy and it creates the idea that they don't need help. They're so smart. You know, the super Jew, the super Asian, who needs to hire them? They have money. How could they possibly need me to hire them? That kind of prejudice actually hurts Asians and it hurts Jews. Friday was Holocaust Remembrance Day. The Holocaust, it is illegal to deny the Holocaust in Germany, in France, and Great Britain because in Europe they knew that there's an element of society that over time will choose to rewrite history and come up with alternative facts. Kind of controversial whether or not that is a violation of freedom of speech, but it is illegal to deny the Holocaust because some things happened. Some things are true. Some things are so incredible that they defy credibility. So it's easy to then start to believe an alternative universe because you just cannot believe that 6 million Jews were marched into the ovens. And sure enough, what has gone on over the past several decades is we now have Holocaust deniers. They deny that the Holocaust either actually happened or that it was as bad as it really was. Holocaust denying 101 is to say not as many Jews died as 6 million. That number, it's probably more than 6 million Jews. And at the beginning, you know, when they first unraveled the Holocaust and found out what really happened, they were Americans and the French and even the Germans and the British were smart enough to say, nobody's going to believe this. Nobody is going to believe this story. And they will choose to forget it or rewrite it. And over time, that is what has happened. People have said, well, it wasn't really 6 million. The numbers were inflated. Friday was Holocaust Remembrance Day, and the President Bannon, issued a statement on Holocaust Remembrance Day, and it left out the fact, I'm laughing because it's just so absurd, it left out the fact that 6 million Jews were incinerated during the Holocaust. Hope Hicks, one of the spokesmen for President Bannon, said that they did that on purpose. That they intentionally left out the 6 million Jews because 5 million other people were exterminated, including priests, gypsies, people with mental or physical deformities, communists, trade unionists, Jehovah's Witnesses, anarchists, Poles, and other Slavic people, as well as resistance fighters. Hope Hicks, a spokesman for President Bannon, said, it was our honor to issue a statement in remembrance of this important day, but to mention the 6 million Jews, we would have been neglecting the priests, gypsies, people with mental or physical disabilities, communists, trade unionists, Jehovah's Witnesses, anarchists, Poles, and other Slavic peoples, and resistance fighters. If you go to a Holocaust museum, and I think in 2 years, there will be a Holocaust museum in every city in America. You will be reminded that it wasn't just 6 million Jews, that there were other people who were killed in the Holocaust. But here's the difference, and this is why you have to mention 6 million Jews. 6 million priests were not exterminated. 6 million gypsies were not exterminated. Six people with mental or physical deformities were not exterminated. 6 million Poles, Polish people, were not exterminated. 6 million resistance fighters were not exterminated. 6 million Jews were exterminated. And Hitler rose to power promising to take care of the Jews. So when you talk about the Holocaust, you have to include the 6 million Jews. When you talk about the Holocaust, you have to include the 5 million priests, gypsies, people with mental or physical deformities, communists, trade unionists, Jehovah's Witnesses, anarchists, Poles, and Slavic people, and resistance fighters. That is how you remember the Holocaust. Every president on Holocaust Remembrance Day has made sure to do that, except President Bannon. Why? Because President Bannon is an anti-Semite, which means he hates the Semitic people. The reason he's banning Muslims is they are Semites. The reason he hates Jews, the reason President Bannon hates Jews, is because they are Semites. The reason President Bannon supports Netanyahu and Israel is he wants the Semites to be in Israel, not here, because President Bannon hates Semites. Arabs are Semites. Jews are Semites, and President Bannon hates Semites. That's a fact. That's not an alternative fact. That's a fact. 6 months ago in the Times of Israel, they went over President Bannon's long history of anti-Semitism. One of the things President Bannon did was he went after Ann Applebaum, a Washington Post columnist. He accused her of orchestrating attempts, quote, to impose a globalist worldview upon citizens that reject it. That's classic anti-Semitism, globalist worldwide views. He said she's in the pocket of George Soros, a favorite target, Jewish target among the alt-right. And the column in Breitbart that President Bannon ran included the sentence, "Hell hath no fury like a Polish Jewish American elitist scorned." President Bannon, running Breitbart, then failed to remove the anti-Semitic comments under this column that was attacking the Washington Post and Applebaum. One of the comments included Heil Hitler. Somehow that was not removed from Breitbart, run by President Bannon at the time. The Times of Israel reports about President Bannon's divorce. In 2007, President Bannon's ex-wife said under oath that her then-husband was an anti-Semite who made repeated anti-Semitic remarks, especially when they were choosing a school for their daughters in Los Angeles. Besides being anti-Semitic, President Bannon is also been accused in this divorce deposition by his ex-wife of physically attacking her. Now, her divorce deposition does not include the word rape, the way Donald Trump, who works for President Bannon, when Ivana, his first wife, filed for divorce, she accused Donald Trump of raping her, but then she kind of rescinded it, probably for money. Back to President Bannon. According to NBC News, Bannon was picking schools in Los Angeles for his daughters, and he asked one of the directors of the schools, quote, "Why are there so many Hanukkah books in the library?" At another school, Bannon reportedly looked around at the school and said, "Was this place a temple? This feels like a temple." At a third school, the Archer School for Girls, Bannon went on to say that the biggest problem he had with Archer, the school for girls, is the number of Jews that attend. He said he doesn't like Jews. This is from the divorce deposition. The wife said, "My husband at the time doesn't like Jews, and that he doesn't like the way they raise their kids to be, quote, whiny brats, and that he didn't want the girls going to school with Jews." Anti-Semite. That's why President Bannon's Holocaust Remembrance Declaration did not include the extermination of 6 million Jews. That's why on the same day that this Holocaust Declaration Remembrance was issued, he issued a ban on Muslims entering this country because he's an anti-Semite. While at Breitbart, President Bannon gave an interview with Mother Jones, and he said that Breitbart is the platform for the alt-right. Now, the alt-right, we hear this term a lot. You all know what the alt-right is. It is a movement that is now in the White House that believes in white European pride. It promotes white nationalism. It is openly racist. It is openly Islamophobic and openly anti-Semitic. These are actual headlines from Breitbart News. Birth control makes women unattractive and crazy. Another headline. Political correctness protects Muslim rape culture. We keep hearing about the Muslim rape culture in Breitbart News. Suck it up, buttercups. Dangerous faggot tour returns to colleges in September. Here's another headline. The solution to online harassment is simple. Women should log off. Another headline. 2 months left until Obama gives dictators control of internet. Headline. There's no hiring bias against women in tech. They just suck at interviews. And finally, trannies whine about hilarious Bruce Jenner billboard. Those are the headlines. So the Muslim ban has been sort of kind of overturned. Maybe, maybe not. The protests have been tremendous and heartwarming. Go to your airport. Go online. Find out where you can make your voice heard. Go to 5calls.org, the number 5calls.org. They will give you the script and the phone number. It takes 5 minutes to make 5 calls each day. You will not only save our democracy, you'll not only save our republic, you'll feel good. You'll be channeling your rage, your paranoia, your anxiety into something positive and good. I am very proud of organized religion here in the United States. So far, the only Christian who spoke out in favor of Trump's ban was Franklin Graham, the son of Billy Graham. I don't know how many of you remember Billy Graham, but he was caught on tape in the Nixon White House spewing anti-Semitic vitriol, like father, like son of a bitch. Yeah, you should just Google that or on YouTube, look up Billy Graham whining to Richard Nixon on the White House tapes about Jews. Billy Graham, a noted anti-Semite. He's still alive. Yeah, he's pushing 100, Billy Graham. He's still alive because God doesn't want him. A lot of Jews in private say to me, well, yeah, Steve Bannon, President Bannon is an anti-Semite, but we're safe. We're safe. The Jews are safe. Not, look, by the way, 80% of American Jews voted for Hillary. But, you know, 20% of Jews are thinking, well, okay, the Muslim ban is bad. It's wrong. I hope even those 20% of the Jews are thinking that. I don't know. But this is what the Jews are thinking in the back of their head. Yes. Yes. There's anti-Semitism in the Oval Office right now. But President Bannon, his guy Trump, is married. His guy Trump his daughter, Ivanka, is married to a Jew, Jared Kushner. Jared Kushner will save us. I've actually heard people say this. Trump's grandchildren. Ivanka converted to Judaism. Yes, and she makes love through a hole in the very same sheet that her dad wears at his rallies, which are apparently rubber sheets, by the way, because he likes Russian hookers to pee on him, which isn't true. But you know what? Let's just say it is. Let's just say it is. So the Jews are saying, well, you know, Jared's Jewish. He married Ivanka. She converted. So the grandchildren are Jewish and they're being raised Jewish and they're not, you know, they belong to a temple and they on Saturdays, they don't work. First of all, Ivanka's conversion by Rabbi Lookstein will not be accepted in Israel because Rabbi Lookstein is a fraud. That's the first thing. Secondly, Jared Kushner isn't running the show. Trump isn't running the show. Steve Bannon is running the show. President Bannon is running the show. That's a lot of responsibility to place on Jared Kushner to think that he's going to save the Jews. You know, he's not Esther. I don't know if you're familiar with the story of Purim, but Jared Kushner is no Esther. Anybody dumb enough to marry Ivanka Trump will believe Steve Bannon when Steve Bannon says, hey, I'm not anti-Semitic. If you're stupid enough to bed, marry, and propagate with Ivanka Trump and marry into the Trump family, then you're stupid enough to believe that Steve Bannon isn't anti-Semitic when he tells you he isn't. Just accept him on face value. Jared Kushner is not Esther. I don't know if you know the story of Purim. It's actually a book in the Bible, so it's the book of Esther. Christians and Catholics should be familiar with it because it's an actual book from the Old Testament. Esther is a beautiful Jewish woman living in Persia, kind of like Jared Kushner, right? Esther was taken into the house of the king of Persia to become part of his harem. And the king fell in love with Esther more than any of his other women. And he made Esther the queen, but he didn't know that Esther was a Jew. And so Haman, he's the egotistical advisor to the king, the power behind the king. Haman, that's who Steve Bannon is. Steve Bannon is Haman. Haman wanted to kill all the Jewish people. Esther, the beautiful queen, was able to save the Jews because she was good and Haman was bad. Well, Jared Kushner is Esther and Steve Bannon is Haman. But I got news for you. Jared Kushner is no Esther, okay? Steve Bannon, the power behind the king, is Haman. Leave it to the anti-Semitic Trump people working under Steve Bannon to find America's only dumb Jew. There's one dumb Jew in America, and it's Jared Kushner, who married Ivanka Trump. Because as I said, only a dumb Jew would marry into the Trump family. From Haaretz, this is a kind of like the New York Times of Israel. Yes, Jared Kushner went to Harvard. We all know that, so we think he's smart. But The Guardian talks about a new book by Daniel Golden, which says that Kushner got into Harvard only because, according to this book, only because his father, Jared Kushner's father, donated $2.5 million to Harvard. This is in a book that came out. It's actually not a new book. It came out about 12 years ago. It's called The Price of Admission. Came out in 2006, is about the trend of rich Americans buying their idiot children into prestigious universities. Golden interviewed Jared Kushner's peers and his teachers. And the administrators at the high school that Jared Kushner attended said they were stunned to discover that he got into Harvard. They described him as, quote, a less than stellar student. Jared Kushner's father made his fortune in real estate. He owns about 25,000 New Jersey apartments, industrial parks, undeveloped land, became very politically active in New Jersey, especially with Governor McGreevy. He was the governor who resigned because he had a homosexual affair with his chauffeur. But they were giving a lot of money to McGreevy. The idiot, Charles Kushner, ended up going to prison because he was violating federal election campaign laws. He was donating more money to gubernatorial candidates than was allowed by law. So what the idiot Charles Kushner did is he tried to do a workaround by writing checks in his son's name and then donating those checks to the candidates. So while the idiot Jared Kushner was at Harvard, his father was signing his name, signing Jared's name, to checks and then sending them off to candidates. He ended up going to prison for that. Not only did Jared Kushner not work for his wealth, it's all inherited wealth. His own father was sending checks in his name to candidates illegally. You would think, you know, if you're smart enough, supposedly, to get into Harvard, you would keep an eye on your checking account. But not Jared Kushner. Why bother when you have inherited wealth? Your father can donate $2.5 million and buy your way into Harvard, or donate money to the Democratic Party the way Charles Kushner did, so that Ted Kennedy, one of the good guys, Ted Kennedy, made a call to Harvard on behalf of Jared Kushner. And then, surprise, surprise, Jared Kushner got into Harvard. Meanwhile, while Jared Kushner was taking up space that he didn't belong in Harvard, his idiot, immoral father, Charles Kushner, went to prison because of the phony checks that he was sending to candidates to buy influence. His brother-in-law had turned state's evidence. And to shut him up, what Jared Kushner's father, Charles Kushner, did is he hired a prostitute. He paid her $10,000 so he could videotape his brother-in-law having sex with the prostitute, then take that tape to the wife and bribe the brother-in-law not to turn state's evidence. Well, turns out Charles Kushner was even a bigger idiot because he got caught and did even more time in prison because of that. That's who Jared Kushner's father is. That's who Jared Kushner is. He's not successful. All he does is he gravitates to wealth, like his father or Donald Trump. Immoral, stupid, not Esther. Polyester, because he's fake, but he's not Esther. He's not Esther. He's polyester, because he's fake. Jared Kushner is the grandson of Holocaust survivor. That's pretty bad that the grandson of Holocaust survivors would be in the White House and not speaking up when they were banning refugees from coming into this country. I think most of my listeners are either the children or the grandchildren or the friends of refugees. Shame on Jared Kushner. Shame on him. But if you're as dumb as Jared Kushner is, and that family is, you're also incapable of shame. Shameless. Ma Irwin found this. The Onion printed a headline and they tweeted it out. Sean Spicer's role in the Trump administration will be to provide the American public with robust and clearly articulated misinformation. Sean Spicer, on his Twitter account, tweeted back, "You nailed it." Sean Spicer is the press spokesman for Donald Trump. So they're just going to keep lying. They're just going to keep lying. I have two videos on my website that we found. One is Kellyanne Conway praising Donald Trump. And then the other video, these are just things we found on YouTube. I didn't put these together. And then the other video is Kellyanne Conway spinning for Ted Cruz when she was spinning for Ted Cruz and attacking Donald Trump on all the things she's now defending him for. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com and you know this already, but it will rev you up. It will remind you that she's anything but a money-grubbing, opportunistic political hack. She's an unoriginal parasite. She assumes whatever position to advance her agenda at the expense of million innocent lives and our democracy. There's a special place in hell for people like Kellyanne Conway and Jared Kushner. And that hell is the Trump White House. What a lonely horror show their lives must be. Hey, we got a lot of show today. I'm not going to apologize for it because there's a lot going on. I am going to just remind you that we need to keep the lights on here. So please friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. When you root around that website, you'll find reading material, show notes, copy and paste those links, share my website with everybody. Please go to my website and just start sharing podcasts and radio shows and news articles, because it just gets the word out, and I need you to do that for me, please. Please become a monthly subscriber. It only costs $5 a month to become a monthly subscriber, and you'll gain access to all our premium content, or you can donate more. You know, it's on the honor system. If you can afford more, give us more. We're trying to keep doing this show. I have to take day jobs and writing jobs, but help me out. Give good reviews on iTunes. Give me good reviews on iTunes and Stitcher. Subscribe on iTunes and Stitcher. There are ways to help me without giving money. Money is an important way to help keep the show on. Join Team Feldo. Contact me. There are things we need people to do. There are a million ways to help the cause. Money always helps, but getting the word out, just get this show into the ears of as many people as you possibly can. All right, we got a lot of show. Let's get to it. Dupuy was the communications director for one of my favorite congressmen, one of the great progressives of all time, who lost his seat in November. She has also been a nationally syndicated op-ed columnist. Her column right now is on hiatus. She's a freelance investigative journalist. Tina Dupuy was also the former managing editor for the progressive blog Crooks and Liars. Her writing has appeared in the Los Angeles Times, The Atlantic, Fast Company, LA Weekly, Newsday, Mother Jones, The Skeptic. She writes for Capital in Maine. We just had Robin Urovic on. She was did an investigative piece into our new nominee for Department of Labor, Mr. Puzder. And I'm impressed that you write for Vox. Please welcome once again to our microphones the eclectic Tina Dupuy.
Good to see you, David. How are you?
Very good. It's great to see you. I haven't seen you since Los Angeles, where you were doing comedy with me.
That was in 1807.
Yes.
So very, very good memory you have there.
You played Ann Coulter on our show. Rick Overton turned me on to you. But, you know, I didn't know you were anything but... I thought you were just a comedian.
Yeah. Well, probably when we met, I was. I failed into journalism shortly after we met. So what I was doing when we met was... political commentary, essentially. But I was a political comedian, and so it's a horrible way to build an act because, of course, you get like the best Enron joke that the world has ever seen, and 2 weeks later, you can't do your Enron material anymore. So I started writing these political rants, and they would get published, and pretty soon after that, I became syndicated.
With Mr. Cagle.
That's right. Daryl. That man is a minch.
Who is Daryl Cagle?
Daryl Cagle, he's a cartoonist who runs a syndication called Cagle Cartoons, but he's a mentor to cartoonists all over the world who live in hostile regimes.
Like here in the United States.
Yeah, like here now, right, that we're now living under in the last week. But he has been a mentor to hundreds of cartoonists, and he is an incredible man.
You were the communications director for a congressman who I donated money for or to. I did benefits for him at the LA Improv, and I believed in him. He lost his seat. He had it before, then he lost it again. What is a communications director? What do you do when you're a communications director for a congressperson?
I wrote all of his speeches. I made sure that when he was going to go on camera, he didn't have any boogers or weird things going on with his hair. I was responsible for writing all of the op-eds, making sure that he was on message before he went in front of the cameras. I was the liaison with all of the with journalists and who wanted to book him or talk to him. Any kind of statements that we released went through me. Basically, anyone who wanted to access the congressperson who was from the media would go through me first.
And can you give me any insight into what might be going on up on the Hill and what's going on in the White House? What is Washington, D.C., is Paul Ryan going to kowtow to... I don't refer to him. I won't even say the word president and the other guy in the same sense. I just say Donald Trump, who lost the popular vote by 3 million votes. That's what I say. What is the mood on the Hill? Are they going to kowtow to this guy? Or are they going to stop him? Even the Republicans, are they going to try to stop them?
Well, that depends on what we're talking about. Right now, the Republicans are stoked because they have a monkey with a pin who will sign whatever they give him because he has a very, very slim margin of people who actually like him. It's the core of the base. It's about 30% of Americans who are supporting him right now. That's, excuse me. And he is... But they have kind of boilerplate Republican stuff that they really want to accomplish and they've wanted to accomplish for the last 30 years. And finally, they have their opportunity. So they're incredibly excited, which is until their president ends up having a 29 or even lower approval rating. And then they're going to start trying to cover their own and keep their seat and do whatever they need to do. And that's going to be contingent on what their what district they're from, what their constituents are saying, who is the loudest in their district. There's going to be a lot of that stuff. What we need to focus on now is that all politics is local. We, the progressive movement, we won this last election by a popular vote, but we lost it because of... We didn't pay attention to the localities. We didn't pay attention to the people who were living there and what they were feeling. We really kind of dropped the ball on that. If you look at the numbers, there are people, everyone agreed, they agreed with Hillary's positions, but not with Hillary as a person. They disagreed with Trump as a person and also disagreed with his policies. So But he, because he was a Republican, he got 30% of the vote. I mean, if you nominate a rancid ham sandwich, you will get 30% of the vote, as long as it's a Republican rancid ham sandwich. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what we got. Democrats kind of dropped the ball. What we need to do now is that even if you live in a very, very red district, it doesn't matter. That you are still represented by that person, regardless of whether they're a Republican, and they need to hear from you.
Fivecalls.org.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a, you weren't a congressional staffer. You ran.
I was a congressional. I was a congressional senior staffer.
Well, you were the communications director. So we are now being told by people like you that the most effective way to affect change on the Hill is through phone calls.
They log them. The interns, that's basically what we have interns for. People call. There is a log that where they're calling from, where they live, and what their grievance is. And so if the congressperson does something that people don't like, he just sees an Excel spreadsheet of everyone who's mad about it, or everyone who's happy about it. So also, if you have a congressperson who does something delightful, like my congressperson is Jerry Nadler, and Jerry mm-hmm. Nadler has been perfect.
From Brooklyn yes. Lower Manhattan.
No, Upper West Side. I think his district might go into Brooklyn.
He was the morbidly obese.
Yes, and now he's not as morbidly obese.
Right. He's just correct. Obese.
He might have, but he's been lovely. And so mm-hmm. he's gotten, I've told him directly that he's doing a great job. And they need that kind of feedback. But really, if you want to push your congressperson, you have to call. It does impact them. They can't get into their office without the phones ringing off the hook, and it does change the way they think. Faxes also work, strangely, because...
And what is a fax?
A fax is a... I'm not quite sure, because I'm really don't. I have blocked out most of the 90s, but I believe it's a machine that you put a paper into, and then it spits out another paper on the other side. But they still have faxes, and
okay,
it can work.
Two questions about
Please.
This. So you're gumming up the works in some way. If the staffers are busy logging calls and taking faxes, they cannot do other things.
That's their job, though. Their job is to, we have constituent services. We all pay for this as taxpayers. We have constituent services. So if you are a veteran and the VA is giving you a hard time, that's what your congressperson is there for. The interns are there and the staff assistant is there to take calls from constituents. That is their sole purpose. They can do other things, flag requests, tours of the Capitol, but really their primary purpose is to tell the congressperson what their constituents think about the job that they're doing.
What about calling your
This is representative government.
Right. And what about calling your congressman's lobbyist?
It depends on... Say that he talks to an oil lobbyist.
Mm-hmm.
Where's the record? Who is talking to them?
Well,
how do we find this out? Because it's not part of public record. This stuff is... the lobbyists are registered, but in order to find out the exact one who's talking to your congressman, I think that that's a fool's errand, candidly.
What would happen if I were to get the names of every congressperson who's taken the job on K Street, where the lobbyists work? Mm-hmm. We get that former congressperson's phone number and the lobbying firm that he or she is now working at. And I instruct my listeners, after you're done with fivecalls.org, here is the number for Tom Daschle. Call him.
Tom Daschle is one of the good guys.
No, he's not.
Tom Daschle is not. He's not in power. Let's back up a second. If there are plenty of actions that can do some good, I will give you an example of one that I think would actually affect change. There was a very eloquent, very beautiful public statement by Paul Ryan in July about how a Muslim ban was anti-American and would ultimately hurt our allies more than it would, you know, hurt our enemies. I mean, it was beautiful, the statement that he mm-hmm. released. And of course, now he is completely flip-flopped
right.
on that. So if you are pissed off about that, and you should be absolutely outraged. I think it would be a fantastic idea if we all sent him flip-flops. And then the news sees, hundreds of thousands of flip-flops. You have to send them to the RNC. You cannot send them to his office because he won't get them for 3 months because that's how the Hill works. But you can send it to the RNC. You send them flip-flops from Amazon, any kind of flip-flops, you, old flip-flops, worn-out flip-flops, your old flip-flops. You send them to Paul Ryan. Then the entire story in the country is about this act of civil disobedience. I can't even say it. This act of civil disobedience is suddenly hilarious and pointing out this gigantic reversal,
right,
this egregious reversal from the Speaker of the House. That's how you affect change. Public shaming is really does work. I know they don't seem like they have shame, but they do.
Well, Mike Pence a year ago said banning Muslims is un-American and unconstitutional. Now I realize that's why he's for it.
Exactly.
So he thinks it's a good idea.
Precisely.
I don't know. Let me push back on people like Dick Gephardt and Tom Daschle. Dick Gephardt was the House Minority Leader. He never got to be Speaker. Ran for president with the support of unions, and now is on K Street lobbying against unions. Bad guy. Tom Daschle is a lobbyist. He couldn't even make it to Obama's cabinet because he didn't pay his taxes.
Well, he had it was kind of quaint if we look back and his the reason why he was kept out of the Obama administration. I'm going to push back on this, David, because I think what you are doing, and I hear this from a lot of progressives, is it's very backward thinking. It's like we want to punish liberals for not standing up prior to what happened now, and we just can't afford to fight among each other anymore. I had someone this morning tweet at me that I was about my white privilege. And I was like, I'm the last person in the world you should be trolling right now because we can't fight among each other anymore. That barb was probably really fantastic 6 months ago. But right now the world has changed and we are at war. And this is an existential crisis, a constitutional crisis. If you want to know what that looks like, this is what it is.
Right. But what I agree with you. But I do a radio show with Ralph Nader. How many times have I mentioned that since we've been together?
17.
Okay. And Tom Daschle is the problem with the Bush administration, not Ralph Nader. Tom Daschle is...
But again, the Bush administration is dead and buried. We need to move on. But this is the Trump administration. This is fascism. We have to talk about what happens now because a week ago, the world changed.
Right.
Tom Daschle, it doesn't matter. Right. Like all these punishing people the direction of demanding purity in the Democratic Party or the progressive movement is disastrous. We need to move on and figure out how we deal with the facts on the ground now.
I agree with you 100%.
And we have to be nice to people with whom we disagree, including people who voted for Jill Stein.
Okay, I agree with you, but I cannot help myself.
You're going to have to be a bigger person. We all are.
I know. I just have to say two things. And then this is a good discussion to have because I want to get to Bill Kristol in a second.
Okay.
And then I got a lot to talk to you about. But let me just say this there are two things.
Way of Bill Kristol.
you said something about Ralph Nader and I can't let it go because Ralph Nader is my religion. Okay. I believe in Ralph Nader. He's my God. I grew up, my mother and father worked for a living. They couldn't follow the issues. And we'd get a ballot from Ralph Nader and he told us how to vote. Ralph Nader is God. Whatever happened in 2000, I won't relitigate that with you, but I will tell you this. And then I'll move on. .org. 2002 is when George W. Bush asked for the war authorization. Tom Daschle was the Senate Majority Leader. If he had a pair of balls, he would have stopped the war authorization. But he didn't. Do not put the Bush administration on Ralph Nader. People want one person to blame. The Democrats had been appropriated by corporate America They were tools of corporate America, and they bent over Hillary, John Kerry. The tax cuts got through, and the war got through because the Democratic Party had no balls. Ralph Nader had been warning about that in the 2000 election, and they proved his point. They allowed America to become a fascist state under George W. Bush. And it wasn't Ralph Nader's fault that the Democratic Party is ballless.
What we are dealing, the fascism that we are dealing with now has, I mean, it makes George W. Bush look like a real American president. I mean, this was a right-wing coup, the likes of which we have never seen.
We saw it 17 years ago.
There was no, we didn't. Not at this level.
Yes,
no,
we did.
No, there was not a Muslim ban. No, there wasn't. There was not a an unnecessary, unforced error with Mexico. This is like we've never seen. This is a new world, and we cannot survive. We cannot win if we relitigate the past as liberals and a progressive.
Those
we cannot
who
do it.
Refuse to relitigate the past because, are doomed to repeat it.
Because right now we have an existential threat of the likes we have not seen ever before. Our rights are under attack.
Okay. You know, I would be saying this
if they're rounding up people, it's not good.
Okay, I would be saying this if you weren't. So let me take the other side.
Fine.
I'm just because if you weren't, because we did John Fugelsang show yesterday,
yeah.
And I was pretty much saying what you were saying.
Well, it's true. I mean, when you talk about it, it's like we are just this is it. We're screwed. But I don't think that we're screwed. I think that we have to change the way we've been doing things. So talking about Ralph Nader to me seems very backwards thinking.
Well,
what we really need to be doing
okay.
is talking about how we can move the Congress to protect the, you know, they are supposed to uphold the Constitution. Every single person on the Hill, including myself, had to take an oath, signed oath that and if you're religious, you had to put your, you know, you there's this was in front of God, which I am not and I don't have this issue. But I took an oath to protect the Constitution and this country against enemies, foreign and domestic. Every single congressperson took that same oath. If they are standing there and there is an unconstitutional Muslim ban and a religious test, every single person on that Hill has to stand up and say no.
Right.
And this is not okay. And we need to pressure them to do that. This is the fight that we need to have now, not about Ralph Nader.
Okay. I'm going to move on.
Please.
.org.
Mm.
But
holla.
But if you attack Ralph Nader, it's as bad as denying. Well, it's so okay. You cannot say anything bad about Ralph Nader. And if I were in Congress, I would put my hand, instead of the Bible, on "Told You So," Ralph Nader's book. That's my Bible, and people should follow Ralph Nader and do exactly what he says. And shame on certain liberals for not embracing Ralph Nader. He has all the answers in a cluttered culture where you need to distill everything down to one thing. Go to Ralph Nader. I'm moving on .org. All right. Fivecalls.org. I'm going to, because I believe in the adversarial approach to arriving at a truth, I agree with everything you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm going to play devil's advocate just to make this interesting.
Sure.
We've been here before. The system, we have institutions in place. This is just, they want you scared. Steve Bannon has studied Goebbels, the Blitzkrieg. If you panic and scare everybody, they'll be paralyzed. They'll only think about themselves, not the community. Don't scare people. Trump is just a clown. He'll be hoisted on his own petard.
I disagree with that.
So do I, but...
Yeah, okay. We have not seen this before in this country. And it's going to play out differently in this country. Fascism is going to play out, and an autocrat is going to play out different in this country than it is in other countries. If you go to other countries that have suffered under dictatorships, they're primarily oppressed peoples who are very poor to somewhat poor. Russia is not a rich country. That's why they need us to lift sanctions on them. But it is it's a very poor country, and it's been war torn for several hundred years. You have places like South Africa, where I just visited. They have a horrific, awful, amoral monster named Jacob Zuma, who is in power and is going to stay. Probably will end up dying in office. He will never leave.
Is he ANC?
Yes, and he got elected for two reasons. He's not white. People were quite understandably afraid of having a white president, because of the last time that happened. And he also is from the party of Nelson Mandela. So party
politics.
Is this
the guy who believes that AIDS is not transmitted sexually?
I don't know if that's Jacob Zuma, but yeah, there are other people who believe that in different countries in Africa. I don't know if that's Zuma, but he's a pretty amoral monster in other ways, for sure. Anyway, so South Africa is not, you know, I mean, it would be by every measure a third world country.
All right.
And
all right.
So, you know, you're but making, we've never, right. this is the largest country, or this is the richest country in the world. And our influence is everywhere. I had a woman come up to me when I was on Robben Island in South Africa and tell me,
Mandela went
yes,
to prison.
And she said, I am really glad that I'm from a somewhat stable country that the world doesn't depend on.
She said that.
Yes.
And she was a South African.
Okay. The world depends on us
okay.
to make
I
smart
can't
decisions.
Have you come on this show
Uh-oh.
And scare my listeners. That's my job.
Too late. Is there a delete?
Okay. So, Tina Dupuy. And by the way, Vox.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed that you wrote for Vox.
I'm glad I can impress you.
Because Vox simplifies things
yes,
for you.
Yes, it does.
It is the ultimate... they figured out how to provide news and context.
Yes.
And context through
the art
internet.
Of the explainer.
They are the, yes, they explain.
Mm-hmm.
And they have index cards that they update throughout the story, because this is it Ezra Klein?
Yes.
I love him because when you read the New York Times or The Economist, they use a shorthand. They don't. It's like watching a soap opera in the middle of a story and not understanding what it is. What Vox does is it brings you along. It has index cards and it keeps updating the story so you can very quickly find out how we got there. The BBC does that, by the way. BBC is very good with, they do chronologies. So I'm very impressed that you write for Vox. And, but I don't think it's going to be as bad. I think that there are systems in place. We have, even the Republicans hate Trump, and they're giving him enough rope to hang himself. The media, their institute.
There is hope. I don't want to.
I don't believe what I just said.
Okay, but you don't believe what you really.
No.
You don't believe what
no.
you just said. Okay, that's great. So everybody listening to this needs to get the book In the Time of the Rebels. Google Otpor. Otpor was the group that ousted the horrible, brutal dictator Slobodan Milosevic. In the early 2000s, late 90s.
Serbia.
Yes, these were the Serbians. Yes.
No, America did that.
No, that was Otpor. That was the organic, on the ground, young people who like stuck it to this guy and got him out of there. He ended up dying while on trial at The Hague for war crimes.
But we bombed Belgrade.
Yes, we bombed Belgrade, but that was not who got Slobodan Milosevic out. It was Otpor.
No, we turned off their lights.
It's not we. They
Bill
were
Clinton
there, but
did it.
No, Bill, you
Wesley
can't.
Wesley Clark did
no,
it.
No. That's not how social change does not happen from the top up. This is from the bottom up.
That's the only air
this
war
is,
we won.
This is the this that was after he was this. Your the timeline is you're confused on the timeline. We bombed them, and then they still had Slobodan Milosevic, and he was ousted 2 years later after the bombing stopped. So Clinton absolutely deserves credit. He did not do it though. It was Otpor. The Serbians, the Serbian people themselves are the ones who rose up.
So what is that?
Using nonviolent tactics for nonviolent struggle that if you are really, that everybody should read up on. John Lewis wrote, I mean, they even have pictures for this stuff. They're graphic novels on what to do to use nonviolent struggle in order to stop pure evil.
Congressman John Lewis, who had his head bashed in on the Pettus Bridge.
That's right.
And the monkey in the White House says he's all talk and no action, John Lewis.
Right, exactly, because Trump tells the truth all the time.
Donald Trump is such, Donald J. Trump mm-hmm. is such a pathological liar. Let me just, I have a joke.
Hang please,
on. Let me take
please,
a sip of coffee first. Hang on. excuse me for 1 second. Donald J. Trump is such a pathological liar. The J stands for pathological liar. And that is my joke.
He's doing his act.
I'm doing my act. You are under siege. You are, am I allowed to say that you're blonde?
Yes, I am.
Am I allowed to say that you're white?
I am. Very.
And you are camera ready. It must be very difficult for you.
This is such a weird euphemism. I've heard this twice in the last week that I'm camera ready. I think that's a compliment, right? It means my lipstick's not on my teeth.
I watched the women marching on Washington two mm-hmm. weeks ago. The rage and the anger. If you were to bottle all the rage and anger that was in that city on that Saturday march, that's half of what I'm experiencing in my life with women. So I'm just...
So you were like, you saw the women's march and you're like, at least it's not me.
No, I thought, I kind of know what Trump is feeling, only I'm getting more of it.
Trump's not feeling anything.
I know. So give me some insight into Kellyanne Conway and why she was picked by Donald Trump, and how if you were rotting inside, you could work for Donald Trump. The optics are there.
Because I look like a Nazi. Here's the thing with Kellyanne Conway. We have a saying on the Hill that your job is to advise and protect. Advise and protect. And if they don't take your advice, your job is still to protect them. And that's what she's been doing. I believe that she's a mercenary. I actually don't care if she believes it or not. I think that she's still culpable in everything that Donald Trump does and what he does to this country. I don't think that she should be given any kind of mercy or pity. But she is a woman in her 50s. She's been a kind of gadfly for the last 20, 25 years in the conservative movement. She's always been one of those women who don't like other women. She's the kind of the woman who can say things to more progressive women, and if a man said it, they would get in trouble for it.
Right.
So that's her dynamic.
I worked with her on a show with Will Durst like 12 years ago, and I found her to be an Ann Coulter wannabe.
Yes. She's not as smart as Ann Coulter. She is not as clever as Ann Coulter. Ann Coulter is not someone I could agree with on the time of day, but she is at least, she is smart.
Well, Ann Coulter's a lawyer.
Yes.
Conway's a liar.
Right, exactly. But there is this kind of, you put your head down and you do what you need. And I think that every day in her mind, she's taking care of her children and her children's financial future. She made a lot of money off of Trump, and she is going to be, she has proclaimed that she is the face of the movement, which means that she wants to clean up. She wants to make money, and she wants to make sure that her children are going to be safe and protected. And so that is when you watch her, she's doing a job, and it's gross, it is rewarded. Loyalty is rewarded in all sorts of ways, and she's starting to reap the benefits of loyalty.
I don't understand it. I've never talked about this on the show. I remember that I was working for the Dennis Miller Show for 10 years. Bush became...
What years? Oh, you worked with Dennis before he had his come to Jesus moment?
Yeah, yeah. And then The show on HBO got canceled right after, like a year or two after 9/11. And then Dennis became this rabid conservative. I didn't agree with the politics. I got offered a job to work for Bill Maher on Real Time. And, you know, I was an executive producer of Dennis's show. And they were just offering me a writing job for Bill Maher. And Dennis was then going on to CNBC. And there was no choice. Let's go work for Bill Maher. He was against the war. And I took less money and less status. And I can't imagine. And I, by the way, I'm not going to put Dennis down because I think he's one of the funniest men in the world. I just think his politics are diseased and dangerous and anti-Semitic. Mm. I think if you attack Muslims, you're anti-Semitic.
Yes.
Because Muslims are Semites. And when you attack Semites, first it's Muslims, then it's my people. So right. I identify now as a Semite. I'm no longer calling myself a Zionist or a Jew. Ever since this ban on Muslims, I'm a Muslim. I am Muslim.
Same here.
And on all my documents, I write down Muslim. And under the registry, I'm registered as a Muslim because I'm worried about myself. Because they'll come for me next.
Well,
let's get back to you. Could you, if the money were right, because you are a young, blonde, white, Aryan looking, you are David Duke's nocturnal emission.
God.
If the money were right.
That's like the most disgusting thing anyone's ever said to me. Oh, God.
And his nocturnal emission is whiter than white. Those sheets.
Come on now. Come on now.
Sorry.
I have to eat again eventually.
Yeah. Would you, if the money were right, could you go do what Kellyanne Conway does?
The short answer is no. And I will tell you that Steve Bannon loves me. I interviewed him for The Atlantic because he was the director writer of the Sarah Palin propaganda film, The Undefeated. I was at the North American premiere of that film. I'm using the term very loosely because my editor hated me. And the next day I interviewed Bannon, and we had this screaming fallout, yelling at each other in a restaurant, just screaming.
But it was enjoyable.
Political. Hold on. So
it was fun, right?
He was having a good time, and so
were
was
you?
I. Yeah,
yeah.
No, I was like,
yeah.
But I was, you know, I was throwing him right back because he kept on talking about elitist, and I was like, you work for Goldman Sachs. He's like, I'm not an elitist. I was like, you were a Marine. He's like, I'm not an elitist. I'm like, you live in Santa Monica. And he's like, I'm not an elitist. I'm like, yes, you are.
He went to Harvard.
Yes. Like, there was nothing about him that's not elite. I think that they're using code words. I think that drain the swamp meant liberalism. I think that elite means liberal. I think that that's what when we're talking about genocide, that's how you start. When you start saying things like drain the swamp, and the swamp is like this kind of murky thing that you have not exactly defined, this is how genocide starts. Anyway, the point of that, I assumed that when this piece came out in The Atlantic, that he would call me a libtard. And I pushed back on all of the stuff that he was talking about with Palin. I thought that it was horribly insulting to accomplished women to say that Sarah Palin represents them because she's also accomplished. But now, strangely, I believe that Sarah Palin was paid for all the sins of Donald Trump. And so he is now immune to everything that we put on Palin for being a similar horrible person who is clearly corrupt. If you looked at her, she shut down her super PAC that was supposed to prop up and help conservative candidates, and it ended up only 10% of her super PAC money the entire time she had it open.
You were the managing editor.
But I am a professional. I have worked for politician who I did not agree with on every issue, but I did my job.
Right. The same way a divorce attorney.
You got it.
Kellyanne Conway.
That's a professional. That's professionalism.
Right. I look at Kellyanne Conway and I channel all the rage for my divorce attorney towards her. That's the divorce attorney, because
okay,
she would, you know, and on my website, we have the videos of her spinning for Cruz and spinning for Trump side by side. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. It's a game. I want to ask you about the alt-right, because we both lived in Los Angeles where Breitbart started. I was working for Bill Maher when I met Arianna Huffington, the worst human being on the planet.
Just because you have a media plantation doesn't make you a bad person.
Yeah. And just because you have the same name as your husband, who attends boy parties with underage boys.
Ex-husband.
But she kept the name and the money.
I'm aware. I don't know why. I'm just,
you know, about the boy parties.
Yes, I know all about that.
Yeah. And but we had Amy Berg on that documentary she did where Michael Huffington was at a boy party. So Andrew Breitbart used to show up to the parties. Great guy. I'm serious. He was friendly with Arianna Huffington. Mm-hmm. Andrew Breitbart designed the Drudge Report. He mm-hmm. was very instrumental in the development of the Drudge Report. And opportunistic infections like Arianna Huffington said, hey, why don't we have a website like that for the left wing? And, you know, Andrew Breitbart, he designed.
But again, David, this is ancient history.
No.
You're relitigating something that's in the past. Breitbart is literally dead.
No.
But his spirit is haunting all of us.
Here's, you write for Vox.
Yes.
Context.
Please.
You got to know who your allies are. And who really is your ally? And here's the point I'm going to make. Let me just give me 30 seconds.
You're talking about a purity test for, and
I'm
who's
not
your
talking
allies.
About purity
I think that
tests.
I think that the who the enemies list got a lot shorter after Trump became president. I think that we need to start building bridges and not walls. You and I have to start doing that. And the first, it starts with forgiveness.
You know. Let me just finish my thought.
Sure.
Everything you're saying, I agree with. Here's the point I'm making. It's about the game and how I think the game may actually save this country against Trump. This is the point I'm making. So Breitbart designed the Huffington Post, made a fortune working for Arianna, came up with the Huffington Post, and then said, hey, I created Drudge. I created Arianna Huffington. I'm going to create Breitbart News. And he created Breitbart News and dropped dead. And I will not say anything bad about Andrew Breitbart, because my mother told me to never speak ill of people who deserve to be dead. So I will not attack Andrew Breitbart. But it's a game to these people, especially we saw it. You and I saw it in Los Angeles. This is just a game. You worked at Crooks and Liars. They were getting in on that game. It's a game. They make money. I'm very optimistic that Trump is going to kill the game. And once the game is killed, they'll take him out of office. Once they can no longer profit off this game. People are, you know, Sleeping Giants now is encouraging people to write to the sponsors of Breitbart and pull advertising. Will the game that you play on Capitol Hill, you've been playing the game on Capitol Hill. What is the game on Capitol Hill? Not alt-right Breitbart. I mean, what is the game, and when does that game stop? And they go, all right, now we have to impeach him. At what point does that
That's a really good question, and I have an answer to that. It's the game is survival, period. Political survival is politics, period. So politicians who've been around for a really long time, McCain is a great example of this, are able to go with the flow and stay in office because they change with the changing times. And McCain did that with the rabid ascension of the alt-right, all of that. He was there to kind of he was there to kind of acquiesce to that changing environment. Paul Ryan is a great example of that. This is what politicians do. They try to survive. And so if you have someone who has a 50-year career in the House, they have change dramatically in order to survive. They will look at Donald Trump's numbers once they get, they're hovering now at 36% approval rating. If he starts going lower than that, as soon as he goes south of 30%, people will start turning on him because they want their own survival, which is why it is so important to let your congressperson know, your representative know that you are paying attention.
Right.
Because otherwise they think that they can get away with it. But you're right, there is a game, and the game is to survive. And we are in an existential crisis. Everybody is. And, but this is why, but you know, at the end of the day, this is still a country that, at least in its constitution, is run by people. We, you know, it's for the people, a government of the people and a government by the people. That still rings true in the halls of Congress.
Okay, so the purpose of this show is to simplify people's intellectual diet. That is what I promise my listeners. So we're in an age now where guys like Steve Bannon just throw so much dirt at you, you can't think straight. I'm preaching fivecalls.org. Go to fivecalls.org. 5 minutes a day. It's how you study the Torah. That's how, when I was studying for my bar mitzvah, the rabbi said 5 minutes a day. That's how you eat an apple. The Torah is this, you can never, you will live your entire life and not be able to absorb the Torah 5 minutes a day. That's why I love fivecalls.org. The number fivecalls.org. Each day you get an assignment in your inbox and they tell you who to call and they give you the script. So that is the simple.
It's brilliant.
And if that's all you do,
mm-hmm.
you're saving the republic.
Yes, that's right. That's right. That is not hyperbole. That is absolutely true.
And you worked on Capitol Hill.
Yes, I did.
And you can assure us.
Mm-hmm. This is, I mean, I'm talking to people who are, you know, who are on the Hill right now, and they're exhausted because all they do are logging phone calls. So if you think that people are not paying attention and it doesn't matter, it's, that's just not true. Just do it.
Okay. The last Saturday,
I just think that like cynicism is what's going to defeat us before anything else.
Absolutely.
Once we go like, you know what, nothing means anything and it doesn't matter. And I'm just going to kind of, I'm going to go back into my safe space and I'm not going to challenge any of this. And I want myself to feel better. I think that that's what is really the biggest culprit. I keep on seeing this in my Twitter feed of people just going, throwing up their hands and they're like, you know what, I don't care anymore. I'm done. And it's like, no, you can't do that. There's too much at risk. We're not talking about just your state. We're not talking about just our country. We are talking about the entire world, period. We are not an island.
Right.
The U.S. is not an island. The entire world is freaking out about this. And we are the only ones. The world looks at us as U.S. citizens like we are looking at members of Congress and they're going, why aren't you doing something? Why aren't you standing up?
Right.
You have a despot. You have a dictator in the White House, for crying out loud, who has absolutely no sympathy for anybody. This is the most racist and vindictive and corrupt administration that we have ever seen. We did in our worst nightmares. We could not have imagined. How horrible to have this ignoramus, and to use Stephen King's phrase, plunder monkey, in the White House is the worst thing that this has ever happened to this country. And I'm talking about the Civil War was not as disastrous as the Trump administration could possibly be.
Could be.
Because not yet, but that didn't, remember, the war did not start off. And if you, and I've read contemporaneous reports of the Civil War, and they are very comparable to what people are talking about with Trump. When the Northerners specifically, when the South seceded, you had a country, you had papers around the country that were lamenting the death of the country. They were lamenting the death of the Republic. They thought this was the end times. They felt like it was the apocalypse, and they believed that it was the apocalypse. And then they fought like hell to ward off the apocalypse, and we still have a country because of that. That's what we need to focus on. Cynicism will kill this country.
I agree with you. And go see Adam Curtis's movie, Hypernormalization. You can watch it on my website, davidfeldmanshow.com. He says that when Jane Fonda went from Hanoi to exercise videos. When, you know, improve yourself as opposed to improving the country, that's when the Republicans take over. When you internalize this and focus on your problems and only your problems, you're doing exactly what Republicans want.
And if you are, as they say, woke, there it was a term that they used during during apartheid, each one teach one. And it was also during the civil rights struggle in this country. They used this banner, this battle cry, each one teach one. So if you have somebody who is confused and angry and pissed off and doesn't know what they can do in order to save the republic, in order to bring back a democracy, to oust a dictator, then you need to teach them.
Okay.
Mentorship.
You're going to get the last word. We have to wrap it up. But I'm going to say something. And you have to listen, and then you respond and get the last word.
I like how you're mansplaining me how to do an interview in very small, easily digestible words.
I'm going to say something at you, and then you get the last word on this.
Okay, I'm totally ready.
Okay. You said we need to build bridges and find allies and forget the sins of the past. And that when Cheney now says it's un-American to have a Muslim ban, and, you know, I should forget that Arianna Huffington ran her husband for Senate in California on a platform of denying health benefits to children of undocumented workers. I should forget that because she's an ally. Or when Bill Kristol, who in 1994, as an advisor to Bob Dole, said, whatever you do, block Hillary care, because if we give universal health insurance to Americans, the Republican Party will be doomed. Bill Kristol from PNAC, who invented the invasion of Iraq and has the blood of 2 million Iraqis on his hands. Bill Kristol, who now expiates his sins by attacking Trump. When you say we have to build bridges with these monsters, I say South Africa healed itself the same way Germany healed itself, through truth and reconciliation. You cannot move to Argentina if you're a criminal. There are certain people who are criminals, like Bill Kristol and Dick Cheney and George W. Bush. We don't need them. They cannot hide behind Donald Trump. You don't get to wash the blood off your hands by saying, oh, this Donald Trump. No, you're a monster. And so is Donald Trump. We don't need Dick Cheney. We don't need Bill Kristol. We need truth and reconciliation, because there would be no Donald Trump if it weren't for Dick Cheney and Bill Kristol. We don't need them. So you were in South Africa. People have the problem with this country is we don't litigate the past. And you bring up the Civil War. Reconstruction was killed. We were going to punish the South. And instead, we made this deal where what's his name? We gave the president, there was a tie. Look it up and then I'll shut up. The
which presidency?
I have a block on his name, and we're going to edit this so I don't.
We're keeping this in.
Okay, I'm going to look it up. All right, yeah, let's keep it in.
Let's keep it in.
The end of Reconstruction. Okay, I can't remember. I have a block because my blood is boiling. Okay, I'll ask the Reconstruction came to an end. We were punishing the South after the Civil War.
Johnson?
Andrew Johnson was impeached because he wouldn't.
He wasn't impeached.
Yes, he was.
Andrew Johnson?
Yes, Andrew Johnson became president after Lincoln, and he was impeached because he would not enforce Reconstruction. He would not punish the South, and he was impeached. He wasn't removed from office, but he was impeached. And then Grant became president. And then afterwards, after Grant was president for two terms, there was an election that was identical to Bush v. Gore. Pay attention to this. Pay attention to this. This is important. It was identical to Bush v. Gore. And the Republicans had, it's a, the Republicans at that time were the good guys. The Republicans won that election.
The Republicans were the good guys until the civil rights bill.
Yeah, okay. The Republicans won that election, but they gave it to the Democrats. No, the Democrats gave it to the Republicans. That was the compromise. They gave the presidency to a Democrat, to a Republican, but they had to put an end to Reconstruction. That was the deal. That was the political deal.
I mean, but we can sit here all day and talk about this kind of injustice. I mean, the reason why we have the Electoral College is because of a compromise from slavery. The reason why we have the stupid Senate, that horrible, dumb, ineffective Senate, is because of a compromise over slavery, because slave states wanted equal representation with people who had people who were actually counted as people.
Well, the point I'm making is I believe in total war.
What's total war?
That when Sherman burnt Atlanta for slavery, which was genocide, total war. You reinvent the South the way we reinvented Japan and Germany. The only reason Japan and Germany are great countries now is American firepower raised those two countries, and then we raised them. We raised them, R-A-I-S-E-D. The problem with the South is we compromised and put an end to Reconstruction. That's the point I'm making. And that's when you talk about bridge building, when we're on the side of right, we don't need to build bridges with the devil.
But I think this you are setting yourself up to fail. First off, purity tests are not going to win this war, period. And a compromise is really where, like, both parties feel screwed, and that's a decent deal. Here's what I want. Oh, were you going to, can I have the last word? Are we there yet? Or you want to keep on going?
I apologize for getting worked up and not remembering the name of the.
Okay. Of Johnson?
No, it wasn't Johnson.
Oh,
it was
Grant?
The election. Huh?
Which election? Garfield?
The election after. Look this up, who was president after Grant? Who was president after Lou Grant? That was when Reconstruction ended. That was the great compromise that prohibited. Total annihilation of bigotry in this country. Go ahead. You've got the last word.
Where to start? First off, the turncoats have the power right now because we have a majority Republican House and Senate, and Hayes.
Rutherford B. Hayes.
Rutherford B. Hayes.
Large man.
Yeah.
Was he?
Yeah.
And he was a Republican, right?
I think Taft was the fattest until Trump.
Okay, so Rutherford B. Hayes, was it Blaine who was the Democrat? Somebody like Blaine. And they gave it, the compromise was, well, the Republicans get the Oval Office, but you got to put an end to Reconstruction.
Right.
And we didn't raise the bigotry in the South. Had we continued with Reconstruction, literally Reconstruction.
But you actually don't know that. I mean, this is a theory. There could have been a huge revolt of the South, and you know that you don't actually know that is a true statement. It's good in theory that, and again, we're talking about the past and not what we need to do today and not what we need to do now. Because now, I hate to say it, but you know what? Dick Cheney did something brave. I would not agree with that man on whether night is dark, but he did something brave. And he should be celebrated for that. We cannot be these bitter liberals.
Why doesn't he tell his daughter to shut
up? You know what? You gave me a chance to talk.
I'm sorry. You're right. You're right.
He gave his daughter her entire career, and she's a moron, and she keeps on talking, which is fine. She doesn't know what the Soviet countries that no longer exist. She has publicly blamed Obama for abandoning Czechoslovakia.
Wyoming congressperson.
Yes, she's also my cousin through marriage. But
really?
Dick Cheney is.
Go ahead. I confused you. See what I'm doing a Steve Bannon.
No, you're not. What I'm trying, but I've said over and over again, we have to let go of the past. We cannot be bitter. We cannot be cynical. We cannot be resentful. We cannot. That is not going to win the war. If we sit here and we like we blame everybody and start wanting to take people down because they didn't save us, it's not going to be. Okay. We're not going to win the war. We have to move forward. We have to go to battle with the army we have, not the army we want.
Thank you, Donna Rumsfeld.
That's right. Power to the people.
This is going to be the funniest ending to any podcast in the history of podcasting. Tina Dupuy, before you go, you were born inside a doomsday cult.
I was. I was born for this. I know exactly what the end times looks like.
Your parents were in a doomsday
cult. Yeah, they were.
And you were born in that doomsday
cult. I was the product of a doomsday cult, correct.
We're all out of time. You'll have to come back and talk about it.
Oh, my God.
That's the truth, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You were born in a doomsday cult.
I was.
You'll come back and talk about
it. Okay, you got it. Anytime.
Thank you. You're listening to The David Feldman Show. Coming up, Nick Mullen. Go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Shop on Amazon through my website. Bookmark. When you land on that Amazon page after you go through my site, bookmark it. Put it in your browser because that way, every time you want to shop on Amazon, you don't even have to go through my website. Just go through the bookmark. It'll have my special code embedded into it, and I'll make anywhere between 5 and 7% of everything you buy. It's a great way to help this show. If you have to shop on Amazon, do it through my website. Donate money. You can give us a good review on iTunes, and you can friend me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. And most importantly, share this episode with all your friends. All of you know about 100 people. Spread the word. Share this episode any way possible. We have a YouTube channel. Not too many people go to YouTube to listen to audio, but I'm trying to grow the YouTube channel. If you could please subscribe to my YouTube channel. It's just audio, but eventually we'll include video. YouTube is great for making things go viral. So if you want to listen to this show on YouTube, you can, but it's a good way to send the link to people. It plays well in Twitter and Facebook. When you copy and paste a YouTube link into Facebook and Twitter, it looks good and it plays well, and people can do other things while that YouTube video is playing. All right, Nick Mullen, coming up. Nick Mullen's back.
Hello.
Host of Cum Town. You were on last week, and I didn't give you enough time, and you were generous enough to come back.
Yeah. No, I mean, I felt like we had a good conversation.
I knew that I was cheating my listeners, and I apologized to you during the show and after the show, and I want to apologize to my listeners.
There's no apology necessary.
Well, and you were very generous to do the show, and you're very generous to come back. Nick Mullen is the host of Cum Town.
It's a good name, right? I mean, it works. Sorry.
Sorry. Yes, and it's not a podcast about Lindsey Graham's mouth. Cum Town is a hysterically provocative podcast, and you're a terrific comedian and a terrific comedy writer.
Oh, thanks, man.
And you're very well informed. And I met you through my good friend, Kurt Metzger, who I'm going to be doing a roast battle with.
Are you doing the show, or are you just doing
I'm going to do one around town. But here's my idea. Mm-hmm. Then we'll talk about Katie Rich, Richard Spencer, Emmett Till, the Muslim ban, the ACLU, paranoia, marijuana, and anything else you want to talk about.
Okay.
Here's my idea. So I'm supposed to go up against Kurt Metzger.
Uh-huh.
And I was thinking, well, this is wrestling. Why don't we just stage the whole effing thing?
Yeah.
And I think my hook is going to be, because I lost to Pat Dixon.
Mm-hmm.
He's 5-0 now. I'm 0-1.
Yeah.
I think my hook can be, I never win a roast battle. So I want to be like 0-25.
Yeah. With my limited exposure to you, your problem might be that you overwrite for them. People overestimate how many jokes they're going to need for roast battle. Mm-hmm. So they write 35 jokes rather than just having like five bangers.
Right.
And that's a big hang up that people run into.
Well, I think I want to be the heel. So I think I want to go in. I told this to Kurt. We were just talking. I said, why don't I go in bombastically and pompously saying, you know, I write for the roasts, I write for triumph, nobody can beat me, and I always lose.
Yeah.
And I thought we could actually script this thing and even make up crap about Kurt.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and he can make up, like, I want him to go somewhere that I say, I can't believe you brought this up.
Yeah.
About my, you know, my daughters.
Yeah.
Just make up shit. Anyway, that's where I'm thinking.
That could be fun, or it could backfire. You never know how the audience is going to interpret it, because they went there for one specific kind of show,
mm-hmm.
you know, and to go in with like a gimmick, it might...
Well, I saw one where there was a couple, a man and a woman, two comics, who lived together, and they thought it would be funny to roast each other.
Yeah.
And they walked off stage not making eye contact.
Of course not. It's like, I don't know why people are like, oh, the roasts are so fun. And it's like, yeah, I love just standing on stage and being insulted by someone that I'm, you know, presumably friends with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, because you're supposed to write fucking mean jokes.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's like, you know, oh, you're a comic, you should have thicker skin. It's like, should I? I thought I should just be funny. Mm-hmm. I didn't know I should be on board.
Have you done a roast battle?
Yeah, I've done a couple of them.
And what's your record?
I think two wins, two losses. So.
And you wrote for Triumph.
No, I didn't.
You were in some of the rooms.
I was in the room for one day on a tryout basis because I was friends with Jared Grody.
Brilliant writer.
Yeah, I sent in a packet in January and they passed on me. I didn't get like a call or anything.
Hmm.
And then Jared couldn't make it. You know, he couldn't do that show because he took another job. And Jared's been helping me out for years. And he, like, I guess really pushed me to Robert. And then so they agreed to have me in on that tryout. But, you know, I just sort of sat there and couldn't really pitch anything.
I remember you were great. And, you know, Jared, we should get Jared on the show.
Yeah. I've only hung out with him one time. We sort of made friends with him through the internet.
He ran Largo.
Maybe. I don't know. I haven't spent much time in L.A.
Okay.
I lived there briefly, but... Yeah.
So, are there jokes that people could make that would hurt your feelings at your expense?
I think, honestly, I do get, it does bother me whenever anybody says anything critical, but you get older and you learn how to, like,
mm-hmm.
you know, meter that response or temper, you know, your reaction to it, you know, and filter it through comedy. So... Yeah, obviously. I feel like if you don't have insecurities, then you wouldn't have a sense of humor because it'd be you know, nothing that you're trying to deal with. But yeah, I mean, like, I would if I just went on my own impulses as a guy, I would totally be like a dish it can't take it sort of dude.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I just know that's like a shitty kind of person to be, so I don't, you know, I don't do it.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I don't know. I get a perverse pleasure from. The roast battles where somebody isolates what they think is my weakness and then going for, because I think it's kind of interesting, you know, being Jewish, being old, being divorced,
mm-hmm.
hair transplants. I'm just trying to think, what are my weak?
Yeah.
Lonely,
well, it's the ones that call you off, catch you off guard. The one that bothered me the most is Caitlin Bailey said my breath was bad. And it's like, I can't control that. I brush my teeth. I don't know what causes it.
Do you scrub your tongue?
Yeah. I have a tongue scraper.
Do you gargle with battery acid?
No, I don't. No. But that was the one that fucking hurt my feelings.
But
it's always something that surprises you. You never know what it's going to be. But
bad breath is just something you can accuse anybody of.
Sure. Yeah, but I took it personally.
Okay.
But that hurt my feelings.
People have bad breath.
Because mm-hmm. there's a lot of them, a lot of the time, actually, Mike Lawrence gave me the best advice. He's like, yeah, just fucking grow a beard, and then all the people will talk about is your beard.
Right. But my farts don't stink, by the way.
That's possible.
Because I'm a vegan.
If you get enough fiber, yeah.
I'm a vegan.
Yeah.
Are you? I may or may not be farting as we're talking.
Yeah.
Did you know that?
I do
That's
now.
That's the beauty of being a vegan.
Yeah. Are you really a vegan?
Yeah. I tried
Since
to
when?
Be. since my wife found a pair of gloves. This is an old joke. When did you start wearing women's panties? When my wife found them in the glove compartment. Yeah. It's an old joke. Hey, nothing works, by the way. We're having problems today in the control room. I always talk about how I don't watch television.
Mm-hmm. You don't at all?
I don't. And it's not, and I'm not bragging.
That's actually good to hear. I at least in the last couple of years have tried to transition into having like a television writing job rather than just being a stand-up. And then I talk to other people that are employed, you know, writing for shows, and they're like, "Oh, did you watch King of Queens last week?" Mm-hmm. And it's like, "No, of course not. Why?"
Yeah.
I don't watch fucking TV ever. Why would I watch TV? I just assume that everybody who had a real writing job watched every single show.
This is going to sound this is going to sound so off-putting, but I rather get paid to watch TV than to write for it.
Yeah,
because writing for TV is a joy.
Mm-hmm.
Watching it is work.
Yeah.
Partly because I'm envious and jealous of everybody who's, but that being said,
why I can't watch comedy.
Well, there are two types of, I briefly met Judd Apatow.
Mm-hmm.
And he was Adam Sandler's roommate. The two of them lived together.
Mm-hmm.
And he said something, and it's two types of comics. Judd was constantly knocking on Adam. He told me he was constantly saying to Adam, "Hey, come look at this comic. Come look at this comic. Come look at this comic." And Adam would say, "I don't want to look at this comic. I'm not interested. I don't want to be influenced by this comic."
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I think.
Yeah.
I don't want to watch other comedians. I want plausible deniability when I come up with a joke that I made it up myself.
Yeah.
Whereas, but there are two types of people in the comedy world.
I feel like I'm it's not the influence thing for me, but I'll watch something that I think is like, I'll watch Always Sunny, and mm-hmm. I'll laugh really hard, and then immediately I'm like, "Oh, God damn it."
Yeah.
You know, and then I'm just upset that I'm not that talented or creative. So it is like, it is more of a jealousy thing rather than or if it's something that doesn't make me laugh, like there's plenty of shit, like 30 Rock, I could always watch and I would never laugh once. But I thought the show was very funny.
Right.
I would just sit there and sort of deconstruct the jokes mm-hmm. and appreciate the writing process. And it's like, that's not why you watch comedy, watch comedy to laugh at it,
right.
You know? And so it was just never really like a, you know, pleasurable experience to mm-hmm. watch, you know? Certain things like that, you know.
They're two, and I know I'm wrong,
mm-hmm.
but I'm a human being.
Yeah.
The Simpsons, I know, is one of the greatest shows in the history of. I know that.
Mm-hmm.
I know that intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
Emotionally, Family Guy.
Oh, yeah. Well, those are two different kinds of humor.
Right.
You know, I mean, I still go back and I watch The Simpsons all the time. I still watch King of the Hill, you know. I think that's like one of the best shows that's been, you know, on TV. But Family Guy is, once you understand the formula, which is, you know, we're going to set up a joke and then here it is. And it's kind of separate from the story. And there's really not much in terms of social commentary or insight or whatever. I think not in a way that it could hold a candle to The Simpsons.
I disagree.
Really?
I think you always beware of the comic who's saying, "I'm just an idiot."
Yeah.
That's the dangerous guy. I think Seth MacFarlane is very subversive.
Yeah. Well, I don't think he's an idiot, but
I worked on the roasts with him. I never really got to meet him, but I think of all the people,
mm-hmm.
I think he might be the most talented person in Hollywood.
I think one of the most difficult things to do as a comedian or, you know, any kind of comedian, writer, you know, performer or whatever, is to be able to sync up your ideology perfectly with your sense of humor.
Mm-hmm.
And Family Guy misses the mark with that. I mean, I'm sure some of it can come through, but the goal of the show is to be a very funny show. And it was. I still think Family Guy's funny. I think it's very good at being funny. And then there's, you know, I mean, obviously it happens more on the right. And, you know, increasingly I'd say a lot of the newer shows on the left, it's ideology first. And then, you know, we'll put some jokes in there. The only, a couple of, you know, the Daily Show, it made the peak of when Bush was shitty, you know.
He's still shitty.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, like, the peak of the shittiness of the Bush years. That was a show that did it. The Simpsons was very mm-hmm. fucking good at that for, you know, the first, you know, season 3.5 to 9. And Stanhope. And those are like, you know.
Right. Oh, those, Stanhope.
Yeah. Stanhope's perfect at it. Even if you're not a libertarian.
Yeah.
You know, he's just very good at here's the way I see the world, and I'm able to write nothing but jokes about it. You know? And it doesn't feel shoehorned in, or that, you know, one of, you know, the jokes are compromising to get the ideas forward, or the ideas are compromising to get the jokes forward. And that's like the most powerful thing you can do with comedy, I think, is to line those two up.
Do you know Doug?
Yeah, I've met him a couple of times.
Yeah, great guy.
Mm-hmm.
Great guy. I was going to bring up something why I think my wife ultimately wanted a divorce.
Is it because you watch too much Family Guy?
Oh, no. Actually, yeah. I think, you know, Family Guy was how I bonded with my kids and mm-hmm. inspired me to be like, it was something like I could, it made me feel like a child.
Yeah.
I would watch Family Guy with my children and laugh out loud and be totally immersed in it without feeling, just, you know. And it made me want to be an animator, blah, 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 blah. And it also made me have conversations with my kids about right and wrong.
Yeah.
Like when Joe is in a wheelchair and he would, there was an episode where he was sleep dragging,
mm-hmm.
where he'd get out of his bed and just drag his feet.
Yeah.
And I laughed in front of my kids to the point where it was like watching Gilbert Gottfried, where I thought I was going to lose my shit, literally. Mm-hmm. And then you have to explain to your children why it's okay to laugh at that, even though it's kind of wrong, but maybe it's not wrong.
Yeah.
Because it's up to people who are in a wheelchair to decide if it's wrong, mm-hmm. and maybe it's right. I don't know.
Yeah.
And to have that kind of conversation with my children is very valuable.
Yeah.
And so,
well, what I think is more important when it comes to comedy than is this right or wrong is having a concrete answer as far as like, why are you saying this? You know, even mm-hmm. if it is, even if it might be morally incorrect, but if you have a reason for doing it that aligns again with your ideology, then that's more of a bulletproof defense than saying, well, you know, maybe it's punching up because, well, maybe it isn't, but it's irony. You know, like if you understand exactly why you're doing something, then you don't have to worry about, you know, whether the joke itself is right or wrong.
Yeah. So I think...
That's why I think that The Simpsons was very good at that.
Well, The Simpsons, you watch The Simpsons, and I feel like a red state Republican as a comedy writer, because you're just making me feel stupid. Mm-hmm. All you Harvard guys are just making me feel stupid with all your brilliant jokes.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of understand how red state people feel, because it's brilliant.
Yeah.
And when you're, you know, so I, let you know, I'm jealous, and you make me feel stupid as a comedy writer. With Family Guy, I let my guard down. I'm susceptible. It washes over me.
Mm.
And suddenly I find, hey, this is really subversive. They're doing some stuff here politically that is... Here's why I think my wife and my family hates me. So I was writing on the roast, and Seth MacFarlane was the host, but I had no interaction with him. Ray James was the head writer, and I was just churning out jokes. And I'm very shy, believe it or not. One day, an invitation arrives to Seth MacFarlane's house.
Yeah.
That he's having a party. He's going to be unveiling his big band music, and he's going to be the singer, and I'm invited.
Mm.
And I call, I RSVP, and I say, you know, there's a lawyer named David Feldman. Are you sure you didn't? I swear to God I did this.
Yeah.
And my kids and my wife are like going, this is going to be so great. It can't possibly be me.
Mm-hmm.
So I RSVP, I call the secretary and I say, can you just double check that it's David Feldman, the comedy writer, not David Feldman, the lawyer. And she literally said, no, it's you. And I go, well, just double check. And she never got back to me, so I didn't go.
Oh.
And they just looked at me. My family just looked at me and went, you're an effing.
Yeah, that seems insane.
Yeah.
That you wouldn't go.
I thought they invited the lawyer. I could not.
Why? Who's the lawyer? Was he Seth MacFarlane's lawyer?
No, but there is a powerful lawyer in Hollywood named David Feldman. Who,
I'm sure there's plenty of them.
Well, he's pretty powerful, and I know Tom Arnold, who gave him my...
I mean, there's got to be like a million David Feldmans in Los Angeles.
But no, there's a David Feldman who's a lawyer who was Tom Arnold's lawyer,
mm-hmm.
and Tom Arnold moved me to Hollywood to write.
Yeah, you should get your way into Tom Arnold parties. You should be exploiting. I mean, see, that's you have the wrong mindset. You got to figure out everywhere that this lawyer is going, steal his dinner reservations, pick up his card valets, take his doctor's appointments. You don't need health insurance anymore. You know?
This is what happened.
Just figure out where he's going.
This is what happened.
Yeah.
Tom hired me for Roseanne. I moved to Hollywood. I owe my career to Tom Arnold.
Mm-hmm.
But his lawyer was also named David Feldman. And one morning I got a thank you note from Tom Arnold for a very expensive gift that came from the other David Feldman.
Yeah.
So I assumed that when I got invited to... Anyway.
That makes sense.
All right.
Were you working on Roseanne when Jessica White came?
No.
No.
There's a job opening maybe at SNL. Katie Rich. Mm-hmm. Do you know Katie?
No, I don't. I didn't know who she was prior to this.
Who is Katie Rich and why should we be frightened?
Well, Katie Rich tweeted, I think we even talked about it last week, didn't we?
Yeah, but go ahead.
Briefly, yeah. Katie Rich was an SNL writer that tweeted, Barron Trump is going to be the first homeschool shooter. And SNL suspended her after backlash. And it's like an indefinite suspension.
There was a change.org petition. Mm-hmm. 400,000 Americans signed a petition.
To have her fired.
The same way Bill Maher got fired after 9/11.
Yeah.
When we should have been firing at Osama bin Laden.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So is that a good use of our energy to go after Katie Rich?
No. It's not a good use of our energy, and I don't like the idea that people think this is a precedent being set right now, or in the case with Bill Maher. This is a perpetuation of a culture that's embraced by both sides that says certain things are off limits, mm-hmm. that people are full of shit when they say they support an idea of true free speech, because half the people braying about Katie Rich's firing 2 years ago, we're talking about, well, freedom of speech doesn't mean freedom from consequences. You know, you should get fired if you know, the joke is somehow punching down. And really, there isn't much of a defense of that joke. She's going after a, you know, a 10-year-old boy that probably has some kind of, you know...
She was punching down syndrome, is what
you mean. Yeah.
What's going on with that kid? Nothing.
You know, and this is the other thing, too, is you got to be careful what you fucking say, because Ivanka Trump or sorry, I think maybe it was Melania, one of the family members, threatened a lawsuit because somebody made a YouTube video implying that he was, you know, on the autism spectrum. Right. And it wasn't even a mean-spirited video. They just documented all this evidence of behavior and said this kid probably has, you know, like some kind of autism spectrum disorder.
Well,
and they threatened a lawsuit. And like the chilling effect of, you know, the first lady threatening to sue somebody for making a video that even if the video, you know, that's like, you know, I'm no fan of, you know, Obama or any other, you know, politician really, but Obama wouldn't do that. If somebody made a video saying that fucking you know, Obama was probably, you know, but they did, you know, a Muslim or a Kenyan, imagine if he had threatened lawsuits. You know,
right.
I mean, people would be fucking outraged, and it's par for the course for Trump. But that's something that I get really pissed off about. You know, that really bothers me. You can't have the first lady threatening to sue people for speech.
Right, and I don't think he's on the spectrum. I think that there are certain kids who are being raised in a certain way, and because we don't use psychoanalysis anymore, we don't put kids on the couch. I believe in psychoanalysis and introspection.
Okay, well then he wants to fuck his mom. It's not autism.
Well, we all do.
Yeah.
But no, I'm not going to make a. I'm not going to talk about the kid.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just saying, if a kid is weird, I'm not talking about any specific kid right now.
Yeah.
But if a kid is weird, he may. It's just too convenient to say, oh, he's on the spectrum.
Well, that's why they took it out of the DSM, Asperger's and high functioning autism.
They did?
Yeah, I think they did. They removed it. It's not a diagnosis anymore, because you know, like any kind of behavior, like any kind of aberration, as far as that eventually would be classified as some kind of disorder, like obsessive compulsive disorder or attention deficit disorder. It's an extremity of behaviors that are expressed to a certain extent in almost everybody. You know.
Well, what is wrong?
So
what is wrong with approaching freedom of speech the way we do in this country, in that it's the free marketplace of ideas. There are consequences. And I always view freedom of speech as like zoning.
Mm.
My kids went to a elementary school, and above the elementary school was a billboard for a gentleman's club.
Mm.
And I didn't want my kids saying that. It
sure.
was objectifying women.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, oh, that's what freedom of speech is. This is good. This is a healthy thing in our country. It's all about zoning. You want to have a gentleman's club? Great. You want to objectify women? Okay. I don't want that message above an elementary school. And I had them, they took it down.
Sure.
And now you could say First Amendment, which some people said. And I said, no, zoning. I don't want aesthetically,
mm-hmm.
I don't like that.
Yeah. Well, we do have exceptions. There are obscenity laws. You know, there's laws against inciting any kind of like, you know, public scare, you know, mm-hmm. fire in a crowded theater. You know, intellectual. I mean, I'm pretty extreme when it comes to my defenses of freedom of speech. I don't believe in intellectual property necessarily. I don't think that that's, you know, at this point, it's so thoroughly ingrained in our economy and our way of living that there's not really an argument against it. But I don't like the idea that someone can own an idea, you know.
Right.
But
getting back to the Joe sleep dragging.
Yeah.
I thought it was okay for my kids to see that because I discussed it with them.
Sure.
And I didn't have an answer.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to discuss a gentleman's club with my kids.
Yeah.
So where do you see for the First Amendment in this country? Because we had talked about this after the show last week.
Well, it extends beyond the First Amendment. And I'd prefer to move away from even just referring to freedom of speech as like a First Amendment issue, because it's bigger than the Constitution.
Right.
It's about civil liberties, and it's about embracing a culture that really respects and cherishes the idea of freedom of expression. And shit that you don't like, that's crass, that's, you know, that bothers you, and there's no insight to it, bad jokes, dirty jokes, or whatever. That stuff basically just holds a space at the fringes of what's acceptable for something that'll come along later that might be insightful, that might be important,
mm-hmm.
you know? And maybe it's not a dumb versus smart thing. It could be a left versus right thing where mm-hmm. you spend 2.5 years saying, oh, well, you can't make rape jokes. Rape jokes are off limits. Certain jokes you just shouldn't be able to say, you know? And then, okay, sure, yeah, you spent 2 years arguing for why certain things should be off limits. Well, now someone you agree with has been fired from their comedy writing job for punching down. And your own arguments are going to be used against you by shitty people to do shitty things.
Okay, what about this? I agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I have a solution. I'm concerned about language mm-hmm. and the breakdown of language. And that's why I don't like people cursing on my show, because it's lazy. And I think there's a race to the bottom in the level of discourse in this country that is good for the Republicans and bad for the Democrats. Howard Stern, when he was pushing the envelope on broadcast radio and shocking people, hurt radio because it was pornography and it was quick ratings, easy ratings. And then people stopped listening to intellectual conversation on FM radio. And then the minute Howard went to Sirius, he discovered intellectual conversation. And he left behind FM radio that used to be a bastion of left-wing talk. It's just denuded of any intellectual conversation because
radio died on its own. It was because of the consolidation of small stations by right. Clear Channel, and now it's all Jack FM and
yeah.
you know, top 40 bullshit.
Right, but the shock jocks helped. They were doing the work.
Not as bad as fucking corporatism hurt and a big company, you know, taking okay. over all the stations hurt.
I agree
it's
with
not,
you.
It's not Howard Stern's fault that, you know, the left lost radio.
Well, he was carrying the water in many ways for Clear Channel and CBS radio yeah. because they were consolidating. And because Howard Stern is great, but when you are on FM radio slapping prostitutes and just bringing it down to its most base level, people, you know, Kevin Rooney always says, if there's a poetry reading in the basement and there's a porn shoot in the attic, everyone, including the poet, is going to be up in the attic watching pornography.
Mm-hmm.
You're always going to look at pornography. You're always going to choose the path of least resistance. So you're always going to listen to Howard Stern and turn off somebody who's doing a show that's taxing your brain.
I don't agree with that.
That's what happened.
I don't agree with that on like an individual level. I think
statistically more people are going to listen to somebody farting.
Well, it might be a more popular show, but you can't say that something dumb is inherently anti-intellectual. I mean, there's space for both.
There is space for both.
And I mean, it's going to need more than like the poetry, you know, pornography store.
Howard was
theoretical.
Howard was anti-intellectual.
Sure.
And
well, it was an absence of intellectualism. I wouldn't say it was anti-intellectual.
Okay, and he pushed the envelope. He used freedom of speech to say filthy, disgusting things instead of challenging the status quo. It was a misuse of freedom of speech. And that's what
and I disagree with the concept of a misuse of freedom of speech.
Well, I think when you abuse freedom of speech,
I don't think it can be abused. I don't think it's something that can be abused. I think historically all of our rights, all of our civil liberties that we, you know, take for granted now, a lot of the times those were almost created or established by, you know, pretty clearly bad people, you know. Your Miranda rights. So Ernesto Miranda was, you know, he abused women. But because of a guy like that fighting for his rights, now you have the right to have your rights read to you.
He also ended up getting shot to death.
Did he?
Yeah.
Yeah. Clarence Gideon was a thief, you know?
Bible guy? Who's Clarence Gideon?
Clarence Gideon was Gideon versus Wainwright established your right to an attorney.
Oh.
So a huge part of due process, your right to an attorney, was established with, I'm pretty sure, Gideon versus Wainwright.
Okay.
And you know, again, it's just some fucking guy who's a thief that fought for his rights to have an attorney.
Do you believe in grammar police? Do you believe that the English language should evolve slowly?
I think like a larger argument about prescriptivism in language, I don't really give a shit, to be honest with you. You know, I don't have an opinion.
Do you think when you send children to, because I'm making a larger point about mm-hmm. radio and podcasts and freedom of speech yeah. and First Amendment. I believe that language should evolve.
Do you think that everyone who comes to America should learn English?
No.
So you don't have a problem with abandoning the English language, but you do have a problem with the English language being transformed by vulgarity.
No, I don't.
I think there's a contradiction.
No. I am not a grammar policeman.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that words are sacred
mm-hmm.
and that language has to be protected, because then you end up with people like Kellyanne Conway saying alternative facts.
Mm-hmm.
That you have to protect sentence structure. We have to agree on what words mean and not allow somebody to say that's all depends on what the definition of is. You have to make sure that people speak clearly. and don't obfuscate by using words like obfuscate.
Yeah.
So my position on language is we send our children to school and they learn grammar and they learn sentence structure. And over time, words slowly change. Language slowly changes. And then when you have immigrants come into this country, they don't have to learn the language, but they will influence the language. And then we have Oxford or whomever say, this is now officially a word and it's in the dictionary.
Yeah.
And if it's in the dictionary, then you use it. And if it's not in the dictionary, you don't use it. Because once language breaks down, you're seeing what happens when language breaks down in Washington, D.C. So I'm very protective of our language. That's why I don't want my guests cursing.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry. I got a pretty foul mouth.
No, I don't care. I don't give a shit if you fucking... I don't give a fuck. What I'm saying is, it's why I tell my kids not to curse. It's why I ask comedians not to curse.
Mm.
Because...
I think there's an artistic argument against cursing about how, as specifically with humor, it might be easier to, you know, be funny if...
you're cursing.
Yeah, I think I read something, I can't remember where, but, you know, people who do curse a lot are interpreted as more trustworthy. And, you know, with stand-up, you do have to establish a level of trust with the audience.
So, well, I don't curse, and maybe that's why the audience doesn't trust
that's
me.
That's why everybody hates you.
But you know what?
You don't say
fuck
kind.
Them. Fuck the audience.
Yeah, yeah.
I'd rather have... because I think that the First Amendment should be used primarily and to attack the status quo. To go, and I know saying fuck is attacking the status quo, but everybody says fuck. Use it to go after ExxonMobil, to go after Trump.
Sure, but the way you protect that is by also standing up for freedom of speech, and because that's what having principles is. If you want freedom of speech where it benefits you, you have to stand up for it in situations where it doesn't.
Okay, do you think we would have, when I went to work on Dennis Miller, we were on HBO, and we were live, and it was thrilling because he was saying fuck.
Mm.
And it was, it's HBO. Isn't this great? But then you're policing yourself. And then what becomes dangerous? Once nothing becomes dangerous, nothing's funny. So it's good to have taboos. What if we banned the word rape from stand-up?
Yeah.
Then you can make rape jokes.
You could. But you have to understand.
Then rape jokes would be hysterical.
We kind of did.
When?
I mean, obviously, you can't pass a law that says that you can't make rape jokes. But if you really think now that anyone beyond like the shitty open micer level is going on stage telling rape jokes and getting away with it, that's just not happening. You know, people aren't making those jokes anymore. And it was because of a concerted effort to have that. Telling everybody that it's triggering, that, you know, you're hurting rape victims, with not paying attention to the fact that you can apply that to literally almost any controversial subject. Murder would be triggering for somebody who had a family member murdered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can't talk. There's a lot of things you can't fucking talk
about. I had a
pet
chicken who crossed the road, went to the other side of the street, and got run over. I find those jokes triggering.
Yeah. Well, and this is a trite argument, but I would say that rape
fuck
is...
Fuck you, Alex.
I would say that rape jokes have been effectively banned from stand-up.
Okay, and...
And television. I mean, come on, you know, do a rape joke on TV and see how long your fucking show lasts.
Well, I met Pat McCormick, and he told me, this was 25 years ago, he used to write for Johnny Carson, he wrote a joke. So 25 years ago...
Mm-hmm.
Pat McCormick told me this 25 years ago. He said to me, can you imagine doing a joke like this? This was 25 years ago when he was looking back at Johnny in the 70s. Johnny said, it was so hot today. The rape victims were grateful for the shade.
That's a good rape joke.
It's a perfect rape joke that he told on NBC.
Yeah, yeah.
The rape victims were grateful for the shade.
Mm-hmm.
That's how hot it was. Now, right now...
You couldn't do that joke.
Okay, but right now, my listeners are in a car they are laughing their ass off because they're alone.
Yeah.
They know that's funny.
And the people that listen to me that hate listen to everything I do are calling your advertisers, and they're having your show removed from iTunes.
Did that happen to you?
No.
People, when they laugh alone, laugh at one thing, and then when they're in polite company, they laugh at another.
Well, I think, like, there's, you know, everyone's so obsessed with morality lately that a lot of people are afraid to share their, you know, impulses to certain things because they're worried they might come off, you know, reactionary or racist in certain circumstances, or, you know, maybe like, you know, overly offended sometimes. People have a lot more trouble now just being honest about their emotional reaction to something. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what causes a lot of the divisiveness, at least in the culture. And it is partially responsible for Trump.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I had, and you got to be careful with this conversation. But, you know, even me saying that is me participating in you know, kind of what I think is sort of the problem. But over the last couple of years, the argument surrounding, like, why won't they just say Islamic terror? You know, and it's because then you have to worry about, oh, well, people are going to be racist towards Muslims because of, you know, statistically a small group of people. But there has to be some way to address the people that wouldn't otherwise be a piece of shit. You know, they wouldn't otherwise, and you shouldn't even say that, that otherwise would be a racist, who sees something like the attacks in Belgium or Paris or you know, the situation that happened in Cologne on New Year's a couple of years ago, that doesn't, you know.
It stunk. What happened in Cologne stunk.
Okay. Well, you know, I mean, somebody that wouldn't otherwise be racist that sees a certain thing like that and they say, like, well, can't we just say there's some kind of fucking problem here and let them have kind of which, honestly, yes, a racist reaction just for a second, so that they can get to a place where they understand that's not the right critical analysis of this.
You can have your racist, you're allowed to be a racist
for a day after,
alone in your car when you're in traffic.
Yeah. And I think that if
but not publicly.
Not publicly. And I think a lot of the, like, I think there's going to be a lot of alt-right people that were created basically through this suppression of frustration.
They were, no, no.
No, well, I think that drove for people further right. I think it absolutely did. I think, you know, why won't they just say Islamic terror? I think if you were able to take that argument away from people, that they did have the opportunity to, you know.
I just came, I don't know, maybe this is, you. I think I've arrived at something.
Sure.
Maybe. Let me think this out. Comedy works when the idiots who run the nightclub are smart enough to turn the lights down on the audience.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I can walk into a club and know how I'm going to do by whether or not the audience is lit. And I get really pissed off when I go, it's so simple. Put the spotlight on the comedian and turn the lights down so the audience is anonymous. Then they'll laugh.
Yeah.
But then, you know, the waitresses have to be able to see the bill, and then people have to be, so they keep the, if the audience is lit, they feel, then they're on, then their laughs are not anonymous, right? Yeah. Radio, AM talk radio is dangerous because people are alone in their cars. They're not in polite company. When the joke is, you know, with my friends is, I've never, and, you know, I've never said a sexist thing or a racist thing, you know, except in traffic.
Yeah.
I mean, I did a joke on race wars that I you know, I've never used the N-word because I've stopped stubbing my toe.
Yeah.
Which to me is really funny.
It is funny. It's a good joke.
That I'm such a moron, I'm a horrible human being that that I stubbed my toe.
Yeah.
I screamed the N-word.
I said a similar thing, like, you know, probably a millennial version of that, but anyone tells you that they've never used the N-word has never played a video game where you can put in your own name.
So the point I think I'm arriving at is that, so that when you're alone in a car and it's not polite company, you believe Trump. And that's why I think the FCC has to keep an eye on what's oh, being...
I really don't agree with that.
I'm not sure I do either.
Oh, man. Yeah, I don't agree with that at all. I don't think... I think a lot of the issues with it's these are cultural problems that can be solved through conversations. I don't think that the government needs to literally regulate speech over the airwaves.
But we're not having conversations on radio.
We're not, and it's we're not having conversations. And I think part of a very small
part
of
the problem. Howard carrying the water for the right wing by not having debate by dumbing.
Even if he was. That still will not bring me on board with the idea of the FCC regulating speech.
Shouldn't the FCC say you have an obligation to provide a public service to the community?
No.
Really? Because that was in the that is still in the mandate. If you have a radio station, you have to provide public service to the community, which radio no longer does.
Yeah. No, I don't think speech should be regulated in any way.
But then you have corporations who, through freedom of speech, are able to buy up every radio station in America and strangle freedom of speech. There's no freedom. You can only hear right-wing corporate talk on radio because there's no regulation of radio.
Mm-hmm.
Canada has regulation of radio. They have much better radio. France,
England. I think they're, because I'm not anti-regulation, but I am anti-regulation when it comes to speech. And I think that there's probably other ways to prevent one company from owning every fucking radio station in the country, you know.
Okay.
Through regulations in terms of consolidation, antitrust laws. There's plenty of ways to do it without saying, hey, here's certain
let's
things
bring Barry in
on the airwaves.
Let's bring Barry Weintraub. Oh, we don't have enough microphones? Okay. Because Barry, I just did Barry's radio show. Okay. Emmett Till. Tell me about Emmett Till.
Oh, yeah.
Who was Emmett Till?
I don't know if I want to talk about this.
Let's talk about Richard Spencer. Should you punch a Nazi?
Well, I'm kind of out of time, actually. It's 2:30 already.
You can't stick around? I thought you and Barry could go at it for a little
bit. I mean, I had a hard out at 2:30.
Oh, shit.
The Richard Spencer thing, I'll just say this. There's a lot of debate about, you know, whether or not you should or shouldn't punch a Nazi. And my only take on that is that, like, I just don't understand how people are living in this world where punchings are doled out based on these principle approaches. You know, that's my objection to it. Is right. That, you know, like, if I, being punched in the face for being a Nazi, it's probably one of the most legitimate reasons to be punched in the face.
Right.
I got punched in the face because I said the band Sugar Ray sucked one time. So I don't understand why there's even a question.
Who would punch? First of all, how
a group of bikers assaulted me
for Sugar Ray
for insulting Mark McGrath. That's real. The cops had to show up and break the thing up.
Why would bikers defend Mark McGrath?
I don't know. I still don't know. So if you get punched for that,
but that's a one man show.
What, Sugar Ray?
No, getting punched for insult. You were punched by the Hell's Angels.
I don't think they were the Hell's Angels. I think they were a lesser motorcycle gang. But yes.
Where?
In Texas.
They wanted to punch you for another reason.
No, they just loved Sugar Ray. That's really how it happened. I shit on Sugar Ray. One of them came over. He's like, oh, Sugar Ray's great. I'm like, no, they're fucking not.
Ah, that's why you got punched.
What, for disrespecting them?
This is maybe why did you say fuck?
Yeah, I say fuck all the time.
Okay, tell me what happened. I'm going to tell you why you got punched.
My friend was doing impressions of Mark McGrath. This biker comes over. He's like, Mark McGrath's actually a fucking badass, dude. You know, he's a fucking cool guy. And I was like, no, he's not. What are you talking about? And he's like, oh, I saw a video where somebody calls him Sugar Gay, and he got in that dude's face. I'm like, yeah, that makes him a fucking hot-headed idiot. That doesn't make him a cool guy. That he got offended that a child insulted his shitty fucking band.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, whatever, man, fuck you, you know. And it was outside a show.
Right. And what did you say after he said?
I'd tell you exactly what happened. I didn't want these fucking assholes going to the show and fucking up the show, you know, because they got mad about Sugar Ray outside. So I had a six-pack of beer on me, and I go up to his friend. I'm like, hey, look, I don't know why your friend's upset. You know, maybe we're just having a show here. You know, don't want anybody angry. Here's a beer if you want. He's like, I don't want a fucking beer. Why'd you spit on me? I'm like, I didn't fucking spit on you. Why are you being confrontational, being an asshole at the show? And then he started punching me, like, Jesus. Immediately. Yeah, just immediately punched me in the face.
Ow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel cheated. You need to come back.
Why?
To the show.
Oh. Oh, I thought you meant to that fight with...
No. Oh, okay. I feel we're out of time. And, yeah. And again, I didn't get enough time with Mullen.
Yeah, sorry.
Big
no, I was jammed up
and
today.
I wanted to ask you about paranoia and smoking dope and the FBI, but you got to go. You'll come back?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
I wasn't enough
time. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. Cum Town. You got to come back.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
As soon as possible.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Take it easy.
You're listening to The David Feldman Show, davidfeldmanshow.com. Friend me on Facebook. Follow me on Twitter. Give us a good review on iTunes, please. Copy and paste the link to our show. There are at least 100 people in your address book. Just forward it to them. Tell them about this show. I'm asking you to do that. Become a monthly subscriber for as little as $5 a month. You can gain access to our premium content, and it's $5. I think the show is worth an expensive coffee at Starbucks once a month. $5. If all of you gave $5, you would hear it in the show. If we were making that money, the show would be even better. If you can help out, great. If you don't have the money, I know a lot of you are frightened and strapped for cash. There are other ways to help out. Get the word out. Tell me, contact me, stay in touch. Tell me what you're doing. I'll thank you. Send me stuff. Send me information. I need to know. All right. Barry Weintraub is a good friend of mine from San Francisco. He's a terrific comedian, and he's been doing talk radio for about 25 years. You can hear him on Fox News Radio when he fills in for Alan Combs and does other fill-in work. Coming up, my friend Barry Weintraub. Barry Weintraub's here from Fox News Radio. Nick Mullen was just on the show.
I just met Nick Mullen.
Nick, very funny guy, host of Cum Town.
Cum Town, C-U-M.
Yes,
of
it's
course.
On iTunes.
The kids today.
So I did your show yesterday.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me. You're in the belly of the beast. I am. You've been working at Fox News Radio.
Yeah, listen, it's not like I have my own gig, but I'm fortunate enough to fill in many, many times.
Yeah.
And so you felt... You know, that is the belly of the beast. You're not talking to an adoring crowd when you go on radio there as a liberal. And I'm not even that liberal.
You moved to San Francisco what year?
91, I did the competition, finished third, and then moved there within the next 9 months.
Okay, and I want to do a follow-up to my conversation with Nick Mullen. We were talking about freedom of speech and how it should not be regulated. And you are a cautionary tale, I believe, of why there should be regulation. That freedom of speech can be protected through regulation, and the career path that you chose was disrupted by the myth of freedom of speech. And here you find yourself on my show.
Yeah, which I'm
okay.
Flattered and thrilled to be here.
Right, and. You came to San Francisco in 91.
Right.
And you stayed. And you started getting radio gigs. You pursued the talk radio format.
Well, like everybody else, you know, I was invited to be on the radio with Alex.
With Alex Bennett.
With Alex Bennett. And when I first got there, in my first couple of weeks, I was on fire. I was on a lot.
You were on Alex Bennett. You were on KGO. You started hosting radio shows.
Well, over time, yeah. I mean, what happens is at first I did Alex. Then I got offered my own job KDBQ, which was this FM experiment and talk radio.
Mm-hmm.
I was up there promoting the competition. I met my partner who just recently died, Charlie Weiss, on the air on an open mic. His partner quit the day the station went on the air. That station launched with 38 hours of... The End of the World as You Know It. It was a stunt, and it was going to be wall-to-wall talk
REM.
Shows.
Yeah.
They just played it for a weekend. Mm-hmm. And then they started this wall-to-wall talk show thing, and they were in negotiations. At that time, Howard Stern was a free agent. So they were hoping to put Howard Stern on in the morning. Had they done that, I'd probably have a ranch somewhere out in the Bay Area, and I'd be there to this day. But they didn't. So our format lasted. It was all talk. It started out with heavy metal radio music and talk, and then it became kind of the K-Fog, the AAA album music and talk. And then one day, after I came back home from Thanksgiving, flying, you know, through the night just to get there for the shift, they go, now we have no music. And it was all talk. And we were actually developing something.
Mm-hmm.
And then they pulled the plug, and I think they turned it into a Latin station, which was my first lesson in radio.
So what happened, there was a time when FM radio allowed for alternative thought, liberal talk on FM radio. Does that exist anymore?
No, that was a very limited experiment. That was its moment. They had it in Jersey. There's a station in Jersey, but I don't think it's liberal talk. It's FM talk, and there's a difference. And I don't think they do a lot of politics.
But in the 70s and parts of the 80s, you could have a radio show.
Oh, yeah, going back to before the time I entered the business. But even then, weren't they more conservative?
No, FM radio was alternative music, rock and roll.
Yes.
And you had people like Alex Bennett.
Here in New York, Scott Muni, NEWFM, that whole air staff. They were progressives, definitely.
They were progressive music, progressive political thought.
Yeah.
And that came to an end starting in the 80s, and it died in the 90s. Why?
You had Reagan lifted two things. The FCC and Reagan both, they lifted the fairness doctrine, right? So there was...
What was the fairness doctrine?
This is a case where I'm going to be right-ish and not 100% right.
Okay.
Okay, because there were two things that happened. But basically, the fairness doctrine demanded that if, for example, like one candidate got X amount of airtime on your station, the other candidate needed the same. And you had to give open time for opposing views. That when we were younger, sometimes you'd be watching TV and you go, and now an editorial reply from
Lyndon LaRouche.
Right. Or anybody. Mm-hmm. And the fairness doctrine, I believe, was what called for that. Again, I'm right-ish. I'm in the general ballpark. When that got lifted, Rush Limbaugh and all right-wing television took off. It took off. And it was
So in other words, Rush Limbaugh, who started out in Sacramento in 1988.
Right.
And kind of was a huckster and a jokerman, blew up. Because suddenly local radio stations could put him on and he could say anything. And without the fairness doctrine, nobody could say, hey, there's an alternative truth here to these lies.
Right. He would claim that, well, we welcome all points of view. But no, it was the beginning of one message media. And I found, you know, the right wing, the conservative movement, people on that side of the aisle have mastered the art of the communication. They have dominated media while convincing everyone that liberals are dominating the media, because liberals' faults are that we're always trying to provide balance. You know, journalism is objectivity. I have a journalism degree. You're taught who, what, where, when, why, and you don't go with anything unless you have two sources or more.
Let's get back to why we are where we are. I believe in freedom of speech, but I also think you have to regulate speech to protect it. I believe you need you need grammarians. You need sentence structure. You need a dictionary. You need to say, this word is not in the dictionary. Do not use it, because this is the official definition of what is.
There does need to be some impartial, fairly recognized arbiter of reality, yes, and truth.
And other countries are able to do this. Canada can do it. Europe can do it. Great Britain can do it. They can ban certain types of speech. Hate speech. Here in America, we, under the guise of freedom.
Correct.
Under the guise of freedom, we gave freedom to local radio stations and said to them, you don't. The government is no longer going to be on your back and demand that you give alternative opinions, right?
Correct.
They got rid of the fairness doctrine. Get government off your back. So now local radio stations can have a wall of right-wing talk,
which is syndicated from national sources.
and it's one message under God
all day long. Same message all day.
And so what happened to local radio after they lifted the fare?
It became a dollars and cents thing, from what I understand. I mean, if you were a local station, depending upon the local stores and merchants in your area to support you and pay the salaries of five DJs, you couldn't get away as cheaply as you could if you took a syndicated show that was being made in Los Angeles and offered to you with some sort of trade deal that put more money in your pocket.
So you could put Sean Hannity on, you could put Rush Limbaugh, you could put Michael Savage.
And they would always keep one or two local people.
They would keep local people. And in terms of money, a newspaper and a radio station generate a lot of profits, don't they?
I've just heard that CNN made a fortune.
I'm talking about the local economy.
It's a license to make money.
The LA Times, to this day, is just a license to make money, and that a local radio station is a license to make money.
Right, but I wouldn't compare a newspaper to a radio station, because the airwaves belong to the public.
Yes, they do.
And a newspaper would be privately owned.
So what was the Telecommunications Act? What happened under Bill Clinton that hurt local radio?
I don't know. I don't think I can answer that question.
They lifted. There was a regulation that lifted the number of O&Os that a network.
Ah, correct. And also,
what is an O&O?
All right. So there were rules about you couldn't own a newspaper and a radio station in the same market. You couldn't have undue influence. That's what I think we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And it's coming back to me now, because things move so fast we forget.
So under the guise of freedom of speech.
So Tribune Company could own the newspaper, the Chicago Tribune in Chicago, but they weren't allowed to, and again, I'm going to be rightish. I don't know if you could own a radio station and a TV and a newspaper, but not a TV station or some combination. But that bill obliterated all lines, and these media corporate giants began to engulf all local media, so that one company could basically be dictating what everyone in one community either read or heard. The same message, the same philosophy.
Let's go through this, because the listeners need to know this. We earlier in the show, Tina was on, and she was saying, you know, we can't relitigate the past. I disagree. We need to know how did we get to where we are.
Correct.
So there was a time when a company like CBS or Clear Channel could only own one or two radio stations in a market.
In a market.
The Telecommunications Act raised it to five or seven.
Under the guise of this is good for business, right?
And it's consolidation, good for synergy, it's good for everybody. And what happened once Clear Channel was allowed to own five stations? So this started in the 90s. So what happened to liberal talk in the 90s in a city like San Francisco?
It wasn't making money. I was the classic example. So I was working occasionally.
What wasn't making money?
Liberal talk.
It what? Okay. Go ahead.
Liberal talk wasn't making
money. That's not true, but go ahead.
Okay, well, when I worked at, I was filling in a KGO. KGO at that time, 50,000 watts. When I filled in overnight, my voice was heard from the Canadian border to the middle of Mexico. That's how strong that station was. And they had mostly left and center people. I think Bill Wattenberg, you could say, was a right winger. He was an interesting character.
But he was like a scientist.
Right. So then while I was there doing fill-ins, and I kept saying, hey, man, you ought to give me, I could bring you the party crowd, because they were catering to a very old audience. They bought KSFO radio, and they gave me a show at that time. It was Saturday and Sunday nights from 10 to 1, you know, while the crowd was at the party, basically, I was on. But we were only on for 3 months. Then they fired everybody. And they started using the syndicated right-wing shows. Pat Buchanan came on. I don't remember who else at that time.
So what happened was a company like Clear Channel bought up all the radio stations in America.
That's happening to this day. It just happened at KGO again.
Okay, so Clear Channel,
others. There's not many left, though.
They're not right. Many. All the radio stations in America got purchased by about three companies,
yeah,
Salem,
Right, you are rightish. I mean, whatever the number is, it's a small group. It's a tiny fraction of what you
There was a time when a local radio celebrity could pull in $1 million a year. A local
in the right market.
In the right market, if you were getting the numbers, you could pay your morning DJ $1 million a year. These radio stations, as you said, were a license to print money. What happened was Clear Channel would buy up seven stations in one market. And then they'd say, well, let's get rid of the competition. Let's only focus on two or three of these radio stations. The other four we have will fold into the same building.
Right.
And they'll just be ancillary pieces of real estate. We'll kill it off. We'll kill off our competition and just focus on these three. So no antitrust enforcement.
No.
The radio stations, which are owned by the people, the airwaves. The airwaves are owned by, they are licensed by the federal government. They literally bought up these radio stations, said, okay, we'll keep three really strong ones, and then the other four we'll just play with, but we won't use them.
Right.
They destroyed the competition. There's no such thing as a local radio anchorman or morning DJ.
With the exception of a few markets. San Francisco has a couple left, but not
many. There used to be local celebrities. Sure. There used to be local anchors. There used to be local news.
Oh, that's news.
They
was the first thing
it, they
to go.
Bought it all up.
Right.
And then they claimed they sold it to the stockholders. They sold it to Congress, to the FCC, by saying there'll be synergy, there'll be efficiency, and there'll be money. Clear Channel went into debt.
I was hoping you'd go in there. These stations are so overburdened with debt, these conglomerates.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're all bubble. It's a bubble waiting to burst.
They're owned by Mitt Romney's Bain Capital. Clear Channel is owned by Bain Capital.
Didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
No.
When Mitt Romney was running for president, he owned Clear Channel, or he had a piece of Clear Channel because he still had money invested in Bain Capital. That's why there's no liberal talk or conversation on radio. You cannot hear liberal progressive talk. Maybe
because
Stephanie
ultimately
Miller.
The corporations that own the airwaves, even though they're technically the people's, have a political agenda?
They have an agenda of pushing right-wing division. Identity politics.
But where do you stand on the fact that they're making tons of money on the right wing? At least I think some people put their toe in the water but claimed they couldn't make money with the left wing radio.
That's not true.
You don't think it's true?
Oh, absolutely not. Because what they do is they put left wing radio, they buy up five stations in a market, they give the right wing station the good signal.
Right.
They give the weak signal to the left wing.
That's funny. I'm laughing because when I was KDBK, KDBQ, our signal didn't carry in the city of San Francisco, which is why they had one in the South Bay. And actually, in the South Bay, we started to break the top 10 in the ratings the month they pulled us up. We were only on the air for 9 months.
Yeah.
They didn't give us any time to really get it together. Because, and that last format was only 3 months.
Because the right wing, the corporatists, are terrified of radio. And they're terrified of television. But they're especially terrified of radio because radio is so intimate and it's in your head and you hear things and you believe it. So when Rush Limbaugh gives alternative facts
for 25 years
and there's nobody saying otherwise, they believe it.
And you can't.
And now you're on Fox News Radio.
Which I enjoy. You know, a lot of people will go, how could you possibly? I find a lot of my liberal friends, anytime you tell them you read right-wing media or I participate in it, I mean, why not go where the message needs to be delivered?
Right. And by the way, I want to get to Fox News Radio in a second and dealing with those callers yesterday, which was very enlightening. They killed off all the union jobs in radio. There's no more union jobs in local radio. They killed off all the local news stations. There are much fewer local news reporters. They're buying up newspapers. The LA Times, sure, it makes you'd have to be a moron to this day not to make money off the New York, the LA Times, but it's owned by the Tribune, the idiot.
I thought they were owned by Tribune.
Yeah. So
out of Chicago.
Yeah. So the guy, I can't remember his name, he bought the LA Times.
Somebody who at one point Trump early in the campaign admonished, now is a big supporter, right?
Yeah. And he racks up debt to buy the LA Times. So all of a sudden he's saying the LA Times isn't making money. No. You were allowed to take a utility, a public institution like the LA Times and buy it.
Yeah, you got to be careful. I don't think a newspaper is the same as airwaves.
No. Newspapers are making money.
Yes, they are making money.
But the problem is they're owned by idiots who racked up debt because they were buying things they couldn't afford. But if you look at an individual newspaper can make money if it doesn't have to service the debt of the idiot one percenter who bit off more than he can chew.
All of that is true, but also, you know, we're not discussing the other things that happen in the newspaper industry, the internet, the fact that people are reading news for free. It's harder to monetize a story if it's online and everyone's reading it if they're not paying for a hard copy. That's all true.
A local newspaper can still make money. It could still make money.
Well, there aren't many local newspapers. Like, I grew up in
Yonkers.
Because
they got bought up.
Yeah, Gannett owns all the Westchester papers. When I grew up in Yonkers, we had the Herald Statesman, and they were, like, newspapers all up and down the Hudson River and every river town. Now Gannett owns everything, and they basically have one news source, and they all publish, and they all get one paper up there now.
And it's why the country is so effing stupid, and the next thing they're going after are universities.
Well, I know the right wing is making blacklists. Yeah.
So Fox News, I could not do what you do. You take calls all day from right wing people all over the country.
Who hate me.
Who hate you.
They hate me.
And it was hysterical. I just wanted to watch you. You get off.
It makes me feel at home when people hate me. It's like, yeah, I couldn't visit mom and dad, so I went and I talked to the right wingers.
Have you ever won an argument?
Sometimes
because you do argue with them.
I do argue. Last night I was in a particularly argumentative mood. I tried. You came in. You were very calming, and I tried to take the approach you took, the more Socratic approach when I'm in a calm mood. You know, try to take them through certain steps of a conversation. And every once in a while, I've agreed to disagree. No, you're never going to change anyone's mind, ever.
You've never won an argument doing talk radio.
Well, that's a matter of perspective. For example, last night, you had this guy screaming and yelling at me because news broke while we were on the air about several countries that weren't involved in the ban are countries that Trump does business in. Now, this story broke while you and I were talking.
Say that again.
Okay. The Muslim ban impacts rightish 4 to 5 countries. Mm-hmm. I don't remember all of them off the top of my head, but the story that was breaking was countries in the regions, in the same region that aren't impacted, all seem to have ties to Trump's business. Mm-hmm. So we got this caller, and he said, nobody knows that. How could you know where his business are? And just my gut reaction was, well, his name is on everything,
right?
So then I asked you to talk to him while I looked it up to get my facts straight. And as I read to him what I was reading, without screening it, it said he had a company in Saudi Arabia by one name, and then it went to list all his hotel companies. So this guy tried to play getcha, which is the problem with our debate, right? And that's why I say I hit on this yesterday, and I like it. I'm right-ish. I know we got to wrap it up, but I'm right-ish. So I said to the guy, okay, if I said that everything has his name, and we've just discovered that not everything had his name, but it's still his business, I'll give you that. But in general, my point is the same. He's doing business here, right?
Yes.
So did I win that argument?
No, but I had insight, and then we got to get out of here. We got another guest. And this is how we're going to do the show, Alex. And this is a great lesson for me and my listeners. This is a great, I'm going to give an inspirational lesson. And you can bring Mr. Landers. And don't lower your head in shame. Or I know you hate me. I know you despise me. I know. But that's my comfort level.
That's what makes me feel comfortable, the hatred.
You know what Rick Overton said to me?
No.
He said, Rick Overton.
Of course, I do know.
Great comedian. He said to me, you know that feeling of sitting down and losing the chair? You know that you're going to fall on your ass because there's no chair? He says, that is where great comedians live. Where you're going to sit down, and it's that moment of clarity. Oh my God, there's no chair to catch me. He said to me, that's where you want to be in your podcast, your radio show, and your stand-up. That's where
brilliant.
The great, yeah. And so when Alex says he hates me, I go, welcome to the club. I hate me too. Hey, the reason they want you fighting with your callers, that's the myth that fighting is entertainment on radio. The minute somebody in right-wing controlled radio, because it is controlled by the right wing, they fear radio. The minute somebody comes on and says, forget Democrat, forget Republican, what do you care about? How can we get there?
Yeah, that's not going to get...
They'll take you off the air because then it becomes a 99% issue versus the 1%.
Right, but that's what the internet's for, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, no. The radio, when it was... It gets back to what I was talking about with Nick Mullen. When you regulate speech, this sounds Orwellian. We need to regulate speech to make it free.
Okay. Let me leave you with one last thought, because this has been going through my head. Orwell had it wrong. In 1984...
No, he didn't say that.
I understand that. But in 1984, Orwell had the Ministry of Truth, which was basically a re-educational component of the government. The truth is, we do need a Ministry of Truth. We need some sort of certifiable source of what is true.
Yeah.
Because in this free market, we get what I heard last night, which is I'm reciting facts out of a court document about what Trump University does to pick the pockets of single moms with three kids. And the woman I'm talking to says, well, that may be true or not. It's a court document. It's true.
It is why we have schools. And it is why I say to the right wing, when I do engage with them, I'm not trying to make you feel stupid. I'm trying to make you feel uneducated. You are uneducated. Shut up, listen, and learn. When I'm at Starbucks and people are yakety-yakketing and not reading, I want to scream at the top of my lungs, shut up, listen, and learn. Just because you can talk doesn't mean you have to.
Right. Well, now the problem is that those people are president of the United States.
We are celebrating. There was a time in our country when you were ashamed of not having an education. Now you're proud of it. Now we have we've installed Donald Trump, who is uneducated.
Correct.
He
might have gone to Wharton, but he doesn't know the difference between precedented and president.
He doesn't read.
He watches the news.
He watches the news. He does not read. And go look at his, let's see his transcripts. Let's see his college.
Yeah, I'd like to see a lot of things.
I'd like to see, okay. All right, now I'm going to be inspirational. You can go get Mr. Landers, but I'm going to inspire the audience. And I'm going to inspire you. We're having technical difficulties today, Alex. We were going to do a roundtable. I was going to have you, Mr. Landers.
Met him, very funny.
Yeah, and Mr. Kattan, and we were going to do a roundtable. Would you come back if I said to you, I need you to come in, just do 20 minutes one-on-one? Would you do that?
Sure.
Would you prefer that to a roundtable?
I wouldn't have either preference. Yeah. I mean, it was fun talking to you, and I learned a lot here today, but it's always fun to get that energy when people kick it around.
I believe that, especially in show business, you got to embrace the problems. It's Apollo 13. Everything in life is Apollo 13. Folks, it can either be our greatest moment or not. You have to rise to the occasion. I believe, as either Deke Slayton or Gene Kranz said, when Apollo 13 looked like the Aquarius,
right.
He said, I believe this is going to be NASA's finest moment. And we only remember Apollo 13 and Apollo 11, and we don't even remember all the other people who walked on the moon. We remember Apollo 13. This is America's Apollo 13 moment. This is a crisis. You rise. It's an opportunity. We have a crisis here today.
I believe we do.
Our microphones aren't working. Things are breaking down. But look what happened. Instead of having a roundtable, I'm going one-on-one with our guests, and we're finding a different way to do the show because of it. So my message to everybody is old ancient Chinese saying, crisis is synonymous with opportunity.
had no idea you spoke Chinese.
Well, and unfortunately, Milton Friedman and the Straussian economics team over at the University of Chicago uses crisis to change an economy. Read The Shock Doctrine by Naomi Klein, and you will realize, she wrote this book about 10 years ago, you will realize that Donald Trump is the crisis.
He thrives on crisis.
They put him there. He's the crisis that creates the opportunity to privatize this entire country. The same way they did, they've privatized our airwaves, and there's no truth, and we're a nation of ignoramuses. Or ignorami?
I'm too stupid to know.
Barry Weintraub, you'll come back?
I will. Thank you.
Barry Weintraub, comedian, Fox News Radio. We'll be right back. PJ Landers is here. Hey, buddy. PJ, go to mrpjlanders.com to check him out, or comedyvillage.com. He is going to be in the new remake of Spike Lee's She Gotta Have It. She's Gotta Have It. It's on Netflix. Welcome to the mics again, Mr. PJ Landers. How are you, buddy?
I'm doing great today. How are you?
Good. You know I love you, and I'm glad you're here. You're a great man.
I'm glad we both haven't been deported yet. An Irishman and a Jew, this could happen to us very, very easily.
Or we'll be hired to do the deporting.
The intention's I'm just one step above the people that are the problem.
You're an interesting guy. You're a hysterical comedian, and you also love comedy, and you support young comics. You're also an Army guy.
I am. You're First Cavalry out of Texas.
First Cavalry out of Texas.
Yeah.
And a first responder.
I am.
A photographer.
I got arrested last year because of my photography, my journalism.
What happened?
I was following the Black Lives Matter protest in Brooklyn. And I do a show, and this is another thing we can plug, do a show called Deliberately Incorrect, which was based on, obviously, Bill Maher's thing. And I was filming, and within an eight-minute span, I filmed a beating of a cop beating up a – six cops beating up a kid.
Black.
And a white, so be fair. It was one black, one white. And like 4 minutes later, I was arrested as a journalist. I had my pass on me. They arrested me because they felt I was capturing too much of what was happening. Hmm. And they put me in jail for like 8 hours.
And that's under Mayor de Blasio.
It was. Yeah, it was under de Blasio. And actually, it was going back last year. Last year, what happened was he stopped this protest. And then after that, all the other protests were smaller. They were smaller because people got arrested for 2 and 3 days. And that takes a lot. You know, the protesters that we see now are great. I love the women who did all these protesting.
Right.
But it's different from the 60s radical movements. You know, where are the college students? I don't see these college students like, what's his name? Not Anthony. What's the guy? Mario. In the 60s, the guy.
Amaro Savio.
Yeah. You know, bringing people like that was real protest. I don't think people know how to protest anymore.
You got to throw yourself on the machine, is what he said.
To stop it.
Yeah. And as long as it's legal or it's not a felon. I mean, there's a way to throw yourself on the machine metaphorically. There's a way to throw yourself on the machine as a misdemeanor. But taking a hammer to the window at Starbucks?
Doesn't make sense, man. And those are different people. Those are not the people that are protesting. They're trying to use that anarchy-ism, and they think they see a movement. They think this is going to make a difference. I'm going to make that one guy Starbucks hurt. They don't realize that that's a franchise and it's one guy.
You were in the Army. Tahrir Square, Egypt. What did they do? What did the Egyptians, what was the genius of that? They were putting flowers in the turrets that they were hugging. And the women were hugging and kissing the military.
Just like the 60s. It brings it right back to...
So if you want to help the cause, give the cops a hug. The women, give the cops a hug.
Right.
They want to be... They're Kellyanne Conway in that they're being bullied and that's a bad analogy. She should be arrested. That was a dumb thing.
Yeah, she's not being bullied. She's going along for the ride. She's drinking the Kool-Aid. She loves it all.
But they're being manipulated.
Manipulated, yeah.
You know, and you were in the Army, and you're sent to do things, and you have to say yes, right?
Yeah, you do. You don't have a time. There's no time with these type of things to say no. A cop on the line could not, he can't, if he wants, they'll take him off the line, but the whole line cannot break. Mm-hmm. You have to keep the line. So there is these search.
You're not like the Rockettes. A Rockette can say, you know what? I don't want to kick. But if you're a cop, you have to kick.
You have to kick. You have to kick, and you have to kick hard. And you have to kick as hard as the next guy, or they'll replace you.
Right.
And you know, that's the other thing. When I see these protests, when I'm watching these protests, I'm there. I'm literally like as close as you and I are to a cop and the protester. And I'm the guy in the middle, and I'm capturing everybody. And it gets violent. You know, the cops are not always as nice as they should be.
Joseph Goebbels, the Hitler's propaganda minister, came up with a brilliant idea. This is how he dealt with Hitler's opposition. The most vocal opponents of Adolf Hitler were untouched at the beginning. Hmm. He said, go after their underlings so that they're just alone.
Wow. And interesting.
And my advice to the left is the best way to topple fascism is to embrace the police, embrace the military, because they have brothers, sisters, mothers, and fathers who are being victimized by the oligarchs. Mm. So the greatest tactic for the left is to embrace the police. Now, if you're black, it's a different story.
Right.
That the role of the white liberal, the role of our privilege, is to embrace the police. Black Lives Matter. What's going on is a disgrace. But our white privilege dictates that we support the police against this fascist attempt.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because if you look at, like, I haven't heard anything about a cop shooting a unarmed guy in a while, right? And maybe there is one out there that's not just publicized as much as there, but you know, it shows you that maybe the protests, maybe the realization to wake these cops up, maybe they say, okay, let's back up a little bit, let's mm-hmm. not shoot another armed guy, and not that they're putting themselves in risk, but it shows that if we do work with the police, that maybe they will realize all of our plight here.
And we had a guest earlier on the show today who was saying that this is the worst it's ever been. Is it the worst?
In what way?
That our freedom of speech, it's the assault, it's 1 week in, right, and this is the biggest assault on our freedoms. Is it fair to say, look, with Trump, I have to preface this by saying,
you're a fan of Trump's, right? Didn't you vote for him?
Well, yeah. Don't tell anybody.
I'm in this studio right now, and there's a 6-foot poster of Trump.
Don't tell anybody.
With a smile.
I'm a billionaire. Don't tell anybody.
And a glory hole.
Yeah. Well, that has nothing to do with the money. That's just, no, I have to say I didn't vote. By the way, my vote didn't even get cast. I'm a Bernie bro. But that I missed, everybody missed the boat on Trump. So you can't, now we have to say we were wrong every step of the way. Now we're going, oh my God.
Right, what do we do?
Yeah, we were, so, you know, I want to be wrong by overreacting to this.
Well, because you talk about where we all made a mistake. I didn't vote for him either. I realized who he was right from the beginning. A showman, like, he didn't realize that he was going to be in the election this long. He had no idea he was going to win. His ego told him, yeah, I can win, but he had no idea.
You know what this is? This is a movie that Robin Williams would do so that he could do the art film. Robin Williams would take this role as Donald Trump to make enough money to support the art films that he wanted to make.
Yeah, I think, you know, when you think of Donald Trump and his, all these people who bought into it, they just bought into, like, the silliest things. You know, he was able to throw up the ball and the pins to what make you look, oh, look how good I'm doing. And all of a sudden, he's sneaking these things.
He's right under.
Let me sign this. And, you know, people don't understand what it means, actually. You know, you read a cover here, closing the golden door, right? Extreme vetting. Today, well, not today, but in New York City, there was a thing that, these two guys from Egypt or Iran couldn't get into the city. They were stopped at JFK because of the order.
Wow.
So they were stuck. There's three of them. They just got released a little while ago. But they were for 8 hours, they were questioned in JFK. Not even left, not even arrested, nothing. But they were stopped because that's one of the people on the list. So it's incredible that you know, all of this is happening, and like, what are we going to do? Like, where are the government? Where is the rest of the Republicans that are like, I don't even hear these people. A couple of them have said something, but why are they not getting together? Why? Because they want the control. They want to be the Republicans again, and we don't care what Trump does. Ah, don't worry. It's just the Muslims. Don't worry. We'll put a little ban on them, a little 120-day ban. There should not be one-day ban. You know you're in trouble when Dick Cheney says about the Trump ban, it's against everything we have to stand for. That's got to be bigly bad, you know? when Darth Vader is telling you to slow it down, you're doing something wrong.
Yeah. Yeah. That is... I guess we have to frame and brand the GOP as the party that hates Arabs, Muslims, Black people, and Mexicans. That is who they are. They don't want people of color to vote or come into this country. It's undeniable now, right?
Absolutely.
And that's how they have to be presented. And just to my advice to the listeners is they are as racist as the Democratic Party was during the Civil War. Beat them to that punch, because they always want to go, well, the Democrats during the, yes, 150 years ago. Yes, you're absolutely right. The Democratic Party was, you know, and McDonald's used to have DDT in its burgers, but, you know, things change.
Change, right.
Yeah, it's so disheartening. Are you anxious? Well, when you said to me that you were arrested while Obama was president and de Blasio is still the mayor of New York City, and I love de Blasio and I love Obama, do we run the danger of overreacting by thinking things have changed? Haven't we always been an oppressive regime? Haven't we always locked up the press?
We always have. Yeah. And even...
But it's scarier under Trump.
I think it's scarier under Trump because you think, like, for instance, there's three journalists that got busted in Washington, D.C.
Six
of them. Okay. They're going to be charged with felonies. You know, they tried a felony on me as well.
What does a felony mean?
I don't know. But, you know, it goes from like misdemeanor to felony. So it's the criminal
act. I think it's like prison
of,
time, right?
Oh, that definitely, yeah.
I can't go to prison because I promised myself I would stop sucking cock. And I just know that.
Well, stop 5 minutes from now. Wow, there you go.
What's happening in the comedy world? We're in a bubble in Manhattan. We have tourists. There have been Trump supporters in the audience, but they're outnumbered. What's your take on performing and doing Trump material?
What I found is prior to the election, it was fun. It was interesting because I would say, hey, how many Trump supporters are? And people, some would cheer.
Yeah.
And others would boo. But now if you start bringing it up, it seems that everybody just goes completely silent. The people that voted for him, maybe you'll get one guy who's got a couple of drinks in him, says, yeah, I voted for Trump. Yeah, are you proud of it? Dead silence.
Are you scared?
No. No, I'm actually trying to do more, fill it into my normal way of thinking in life, mm-hmm. and then adding these Trump things in. I want people to know. I said it a couple of times since he's been president. I've said it several times on stage. People, that's what comics have to do. Right. We have to make you realize how fucked up this is. This is not good for anybody. Right. This is not just bad for the Muslims, because if you realize it, all of these things that he's doing puts pressure on all of us. How about now that, you know, you can't look? It's almost back to the days where you'll look at a Muslim friend that you've seen in a while, and he might question you.
Right.
Even though he knows you for 10, 15 years.
I guess what you're saying is, to our listeners, evil only exists when good people in their Frito-stained underwear don't retweet. You gotta retweet. I know it's hard, but you have to retweet.
You have to retweet.
You have to retweet. Hey, PJ Landers, I love you. I really do. You're a great man. You
Thank
are going to be in Spike Lee's remake of She's Gotta Have It on Netflix. Go to mrpjlanders.com or comedyvillage.com. Where can we see your photographs?
You can go to Spot News Video, spotnewsvideo.com. You can see some of the photos that I've done throughout the years, several different protests and fires and things like that. That's a pretty interesting site. I'm glad to be back on the show.
Yeah, and so you photograph crime scenes.
I do. Crime scenes. I mean, it's not like a paparazzi.
Stick around. I think Alex and I think there's going to be something today.
The murder in the murder she wrote.
Thank you, PJ.
Thanks. I appreciate it, David.
Tamer Kattan joins us. He's the winner of the World Series of Comedy 2015. In 2014, he won the Ginger Award for Best New International Act at the Edinburgh Festival. He will be at Gandhi Is That You? February 8th at Lucky Jack's Bar on Orchard Street. I'm there, I believe, this week. Welcome, Tamer Kattan.
Thank you, David Feldman. You sound so professional and so reserved.
I do, yes, but it's going to get ugly.
Good. I like that. This is nice. There's a buildup. You don't want to pull a hamstring.
The Edinburgh Festival, mm-hmm. 2014, I've been told to try to do that.
Yeah.
It's insane, right?
It is insanity. Yeah. I did 134 shows in 1 month.
Wow.
It was like 8 shows a day, and it's insane. I mean, the big saying is the hour you go with is not the hour you come home with. So I had almost 20 new minutes and such a spectrum of shows, because you'll start doing shows at 11 o'clock in the morning, doing guest spots in other people's shows. Mm-hmm. And then, my show started 11:30 at night, which at first I'm like, oh no, it's really late. And they're like, no, it's not late. And then I did late and live. I was getting on stage at 3 a.m. And then you deal, it's funny because British people and, you know, Scotsmen, they're always so reserved and well-behaved when the sun's out. But when they get drunk, it's just Americans. Mm-hmm. They just turn into Americans at night. That's their werewolf.
But they curse better.
They curse better, and they scream, and they heckle better. And they just call it a bit of banter, but really it's abusive language.
What is the Ginger Award?
It was different. So inside the Edinburgh Fringe, there's these different organizations, like Just the Tonic is one. So they run a bunch of rooms. And then there's the Laughing Horse, and they run a bunch of rooms. So the entire Fringe has the Fringe and then the Free Fringe. And the Ginger Award was these group of guys that had 4 or 5 different venues, and then they picked their favorite international act.
That must have been amazing.
It was fun. Yeah, I was really happy. You know, it was my first time performing in Europe for European crowds, especially that many crowds over a period of time. And, it was the first time where I was sort of a novelty.
Yeah.
You know, in the UK, it was interesting to be the foreigner, to be the one with the accent.
Right.
That was a trip.
Right. Yeah. And they're smart audiences, right?
It's very smart audiences.
Literate. And international or mostly great?
Very international.
Commonwealth?
A lot of, well, in terms of the other comedians, they were very British. Mostly England, a lot of Irish, a lot of Scottish.
Right.
But the audiences were extremely international.
Right.
I mean, people from South Africa would come, Canada, America. The audiences were from all over the place.
This is a meme that I found on the internet. Why we love Scotland. And there's a picture of Donald Trump. And these are curses, descriptions of Donald Trump from Scotland. Butt plug face, toupeed fuck trumpet, cock womble, mangled apricot hell beast, witless fucking cock splat, incompressible jizz trumpet, ignorant fuck muppet, and finally, tiny fingered, Cheeto faced, ferret wearing shit gibbon.
I love it. I love it.
That's why everybody.
God bless Scotland.
And God bless Veep and In the Loop. You ever watch those TV shows?
Veep, yeah. What did they do?
Well, the Armando Iannucci hired a guy from Scotland as a professional curser.
Amazing.
And because they know how to curse.
Yeah.
And so if you watch the movie In the Loop, which was written by Armando Iannucci.
Oh, I got to check it out.
The guy who's playing Doctor Who now just has these great curses.
That's great.
And they're written by a Scot that Armando Iannucci hired. And his British series that In the Loop is an extension of his British series. Anyway, let's talk about performing overseas. You performed in Great Britain. You were welcome there.
Yeah.
You know, American comics have difficulty performing, making money overseas because we do not allow foreigners to perform here in America. We make it very difficult. Whenever I go up to Montreal, I've been writing for the Montreal Comedy Festival for years, thanks to Mr. Jeff Singer and other people. And I always hear complaints from English-speaking foreigners that they can't get into America unless they bang and marry one of our women.
Yeah.
It's hard for foreigners to come to...
Are you saying foreigners that way on purpose?
Yeah. It's hard for English-speaking non-Americans to perform comedy in America. What are the barriers that they put up?
I think the biggest thing... And something that we don't realize is the influence of our entertainment industry. Even when we make a reference, they know us because all our TV shows are omnipresent, regardless of the country. Like, I have a friend in Sweden who's an amazing comedian, and he grew up in Sweden, raised in Sweden, grew up with English professors. And when he performs in London, they're like, why do you have an American accent? And they give him shit for it. And he goes, listen, if you want me to speak with a British accent, you should have made better films. And that's our reality. We're lucky that even almost any of our references they get.
He was born in Sweden.
Born in Sweden, never lived in America, but speak English with an American accent.
So the world, the lingua franca is English.
Mm, yeah,
which is kind of ironic since lingua franca is a French. Right?
Yeah.
It was the language of diplomacy in the 19th century. But now the lingua franca is English. That's depressing. So an English-speaking performer can pretty much go to Germany.
Yeah.
Speak English.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing that happens in places like Germany. Germany and France.
And you've been doing this.
Yeah. Yeah. I've performed in Berlin quite a bit and Munich a little bit. And what happens there is English comedy goes in and out of fashion. Right, you can see it. Like right now, English-speaking comedy clubs are blowing up. Like I have a friend named Ray Malera.
Well, they're really going to blow up now that Trump is president.
Yeah, I have a friend named Ray Malera from Argentina who was one of the guys that started the English-speaking comedy scene in Berlin. And it goes in and out of fashion. Like when you get off the plane and you're walking through the streets in London, if English politics, American politics are popular, everybody's still wearing American flags on their clothing. If it's not, the Union Jack is back.
Mm.
And that's when you know it's going to be a little bit tougher to get work. So really, our politics influences sometimes positively, sometimes negatively. Like because of Trump, people really want to hear what a Middle Eastern American has to say.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to Trump, they did, to be honest. But there are times when they've just had enough of us. And I think right now it's getting to that point. You're starting to see stuff. Even in New Zealand, there's this sign outside of a bar that says Americans can only enter when accompanied by an adult.
You know, that's funny.
There's a lot of people.
That's in New Zealand?
That's in New Zealand,
I'm sure Peter Thiel will get to see that because he's giving up his citizenship in the United States.
Is he? Wow.
Yeah, Peter Thiel, the gay founder of PayPal, who he put Gawker out of business and he endorsed Donald Trump. Turns out he's getting citizenship in New Zealand.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, thank you. I'll pay for the airfare, Peter, to get the hell out of my country.
Yeah.
So is it easy for you as an American to get booked overseas? Because I've always thought because we were blocking foreigners, they reciprocated by blocking us. So is it harder for you to travel around the world?
I was lucky. I think I was lucky because I got to London and I developed in London. So I think in a lot of ways, they look at me as one of their own.
Mm-hmm.
And even, I think my style of comedy, even when I perform comedy in the States, I've had British audience members come out to me and go, you remind me of a British comic.
Right. Why did you develop in England, in London?
I started in LA and I had a full-time job and I was only gigging like 3 times a week and still working advertising during the day. When I went to the Edinburgh Fringe, I won this competition and I was given an artist residency. So that's when I quit the day job, moved to London.
What does artist residency mean?
Basically, I got to live in a comedy condo and paid $300 a month, and I got a performer's visa that guaranteed I made more money than I would pay for rent.
So that's un-American.
Huh? It is un-American. Yeah, it is un-American.
So. And how long did the visa last?
It was every 3 months I'd have to go to France for the weekend. I'd go to Paris, I'd gig in Paris, and then I'd come back. And also discovered something in Paris. My name is Tamer, but in French, Tamer means your mother. Mm. And the comic before me, this one night, his name was Nick, and Nick means fuck. So the host said, give it up for Nick and your next comic, Tamer. It was like, fuck your mother. So my name became a punchline in Paris. Like every time I'd go up, they had a show called French Fried Comedy. It was all about American comics performing. There's probably about 20 American comics that live in that live in Paris.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, they're great. His first name, B-E-A-R, is the last name. I think his real name's Robert, but he goes by Robert.
Well,
shout out to Robert.
Do they perform in French or in English?
In English.
In English.
So English-speaking comedy right now is in vogue, but then there'll be times where it goes out.
What about in Montreal?
I don't know in Montreal. I've never gigged. I've never gigged in Quebec.
You know what it is with my experience with Montreal, where I love Montreal, is I wonder how, so you can be an English-speaking person in France.
Yeah.
And do comedy.
Yeah, which is rare because France is usually, France and Germany in particular, they are so proud of their own languages. They're two of the only countries in Europe where they always dub their films instead of subtitles because they want to maintain the mother tongue. And so I was really surprised to see that.
Well, it sounded like you wanted to maintain the mother tongue while you were in France, right?
I did. I absolutely did. French women, my God, they're amazing.
Why?
I think because culturally, at a very young age, this is going to sound creepy, but it is acceptable for young girls to date much older men. And it's almost like a rite of passage where the old guy teaches them about sex, and then later on in life they date guys that are more age appropriate. But to see like a young girl with an older guy is not that big of a deal. Not necessarily being that I want to be the older guy with a young girl, but when I did meet French
girls. But you wouldn't mind being the younger girl some older guy.
Well, I wouldn't mind being the recipient, you know, the recipient of the benefit of the education.
Right.
So these young girls that were really open sexually. You know, same in Sweden. These girls are just really open sexually and, you know, like...
You keep talking, I gotta go book a flight.
But it's great, man. Like, even, you know the phrase, let's go Dutch? That's Scandinavian culture, right? Like, we forget it's called Dutch because it's Scandinavian culture. Women do not expect you to pay. Even when I opened a door, girls' knees would buckle. Like, Swedish guys, it's 50-50 there to a fault. There was a girl on a train. I helped her put her luggage up. She was like, I'm going to fuck you. Like, she, just because I helped her put her luggage up. Like, I think it's changing a little bit. Like, Sweden's gotten a little westernized with American influence. But man, if you did little gentlemanly things, man, did it make a difference.
So why aren't the guys, what is this? They overcorrected for feminism?
Stockholm and London are both boys towns. They're so sports crazy that if a girl wants to meet a guy, the girl has to go to where the guys are. In America, it's the other way around.
What is it, gay
guys
country?
Have to go to where the, yeah, so you think, like, right? Girls are way more laid back because men rule the clubs in the sense that men are the ones who make the clubs successful. So the clubs are tailored for men. Whereas here, if the pretty girls go, the guys go. So I think over there, it's more of a boys' world, and the girls are way more laid back and way more open to meeting guys. And if you behave in a way where you're a little bit kinder to women, boy, do you reap the benefits.
And do you think women in America appreciate tenderness and kindness?
I do. Yeah, I think I do, but they want it to be authentic. That's the bummer. You know, if you're a guy that genuinely wants to know a girl's sign, you're fucked. Mm-hmm. You know? Like, what's your sign? I really care. Just like, fuck you. Hmm. You know, people have bastardized opening lines, like, because they get so attacked, it's hard for the authentic.
Are you married?
No. Single guy. I have a girlfriend, a new relationship, and it's fantastic. I'm lucky.
And how often are you traveling overseas?
Probably twice a year. Now that I'm in the States, I finished an album in the States, so I really wanted to come here, work on that hour, and I really want to make it here more than I did in Europe. But now that I'm in New York, now I'm going to be going to Europe more often, because from LA to London was a much tougher flight and much tougher to do gigs, whereas now I can totally do that. Yeah. Now it's the flight from New York to London or New York to LA, it's equidistant. So now it opens up my jobs.
Is it fair to say that comedians are treated better in Europe
100%
than they are in the United States?
100%.
But I'm told we're number one and everybody wants to make it here in the
Oh man, the weirdest and saddest I felt after feeling good was when I got off the stage in London and realized I was more free on stage.
What do you mean?
I was more free to speak about whatever topic I wanted to speak about, and the audience would give me an opportunity to speak. The other thing is, when you're performing in London at most of the good shows, you're not even allowed to order drinks when a comic's on stage. There's three comics and then there's an intermission, and you can get your drinks, you can get your cigarettes, and everybody comes back 15 minutes later like adults, and then there's three more comics and that's the show. And you can't order drinks. If you heckle, you're kicked out. And then there's other clubs, you know, like Jonglers, which is like, that's where all the bachelor and bachelorette parties go, and it's a madhouse. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, I mean, places like the Comedy Store, the Comedy Store in London is just like, I've never felt an audience like that. They say that they built the building around the stage, and they did. I mean, it's a pizza wedge that comes to the stage, and the ceiling also comes down. So the first time I hit a big laugh on that stage, it felt like a giant finger poked me in the chest. I've never felt an audience like that.
Is it too easy?
No.
Because there is this idea here in Manhattan that you got to punch it out in one shithole after another to really find out if a bit is funny.
Yeah.
Can you get spoiled?
You know what I think? I don't think so, because the Comedy Store also has this, they have this culture there of banter, right? Where the audience gives the comic shit. And if the joke's not good, they'll tell you. Mm-hmm. Like, the way you get passed for like new comics at the Comedy Store in London is a show called King Gong. So what they do is you go up, you have 5 minutes. And while you're performing, there's a gong behind you. And there's red cards handed out to people in the audience. And if they don't like you, they raise these red cards. And once they get three cards, you hit the gong and you're off. Wow. You're off stage. So there's that culture there.
Right.
And so it keeps them coming at you. The one thing that's different, I think the sweet spot is in between their culture and ours, is, you know, Louis was talking about how, you know, a new hour every year, like Carlin did. Well, in the UK, that's kind of par for the course because of the presence of the Edinburgh Festival. If you do a 1 hour set 1 year in Edinburgh, you get reviewed by all the publications. And if you go back the next year and you have the same 1 hour, you don't get reviewed. So everybody, every comic there writes a new hour every year.
They all have health insurance?
Yeah, national healthcare. Yeah, absolutely.
They're not as frightened as...
Not at all.
And they're creative?
Yeah.
What about their work ethic? I mean, what about, you know, you give comics dental, healthcare. Doesn't that make them lazy? That's what I would be told.
No, you know, they almost work too hard. Because of the presence.
But don't you have to be frightened, scared?
And, yeah, I agree with
that. No, I'm joking.
Fear is good. You need to put salt in the soup a little bit.
I think this country, we are a third world nation. We just don't know it.
Yeah. Oh, no, I absolutely agree with that.
It
doesn't feel, I remember, here's the thing that blew me away. I went to Sweden. And when I wanted to learn Swedish, because I started school in Sweden and my friends were already enrolled and I had to wait.
You went to school in Sweden?
Yeah, to University of Lund in southern Sweden. So when I was...
University of what?
Lund, L-U-N-D.
Okay.
It's in southern Sweden. So I was taking like a certificate coursework there and my friends were in class. So I started going to the movie theater because they subtitle there. So Judge Dredd was playing a Stallone film and it was rated X. And I was like, whoa, is Stallone doing porn out here? And I didn't know, and I saw normal people going in, so I'm like, all right, I'm going to go see it. Regular Stallone film, rated X. 2 weeks later, I see a Swedish film with my friend and his 8-year-old nephew, and it's PG, and this guy pulls out his cock and he's like waving his dick around, and I'm looking at this 8-year-old kid sitting next to me. He's just eating popcorn like no big deal.
With a PG stance.
With a PG stance.
Pretty good.
Yeah, right? Pretty good penis. So I go out and my buddy goes, "Oh, I forgot you're American." I'm like, "What do you mean?" And he goes, "We rate our movies on violence. You rate your movies on sex."
That's just too perfect.
And he goes, "I would rather my nephew see a man make love to a woman than decapitate someone."
And what's the difference?
I felt like a monkey, man. You know, it was.
Isn't that the same thing?
Almost the same thing. If you're a, what do they call that?
It sounds like
praying
that guy,
mantis. For praying mantis, it's the exact same thing.
That guy's cock was big enough to decapitate. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, it made me feel like a monkey. You know, and it made me realize that there's some software in my brain that I didn't question. It was just implanted there. It's like that U2 album they put on our iPhones. Like, I didn't ask for it. Mm-hmm. They just shoved it in there. Right. And for the first time, it made me go, I have to start questioning this cult that I'm in.
Yeah.
You know, we're in a cult and we don't realize it. And it does feel like being a cult because every time I leave America, I have people coming up to me going, "Are you okay?
Right.
Like, what's it like over there?" And I realize how scary we are to people. People are afraid of us. I don't know that they respect us anymore. They fear us.
Well, I didn't make up this saying, but you don't want to be healthy in a sick society.
Mm.
If you're feeling sick and disgusted, that's a healthy response to the toxic stew you're living in. Turn off your TV. Last night, I decided I have cable. Some kind of basic cable. I never use it. I need to cancel it.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't figure it out. And I said, I want to watch C-SPAN. And I turn on C-SPAN and I watch the March of Life. What was it called?
Oh, yeah. March of Life. Yeah, the anti-abortion people.
Yeah, the March for Life.
March for Life, yeah.
Which, you know, they're all for marching for life. Unless you're a Syrian refugee, marching for life, then they're not. And I started getting an anxiety attack.
Yeah.
They made me, it looked like a bad movie.
Yeah.
It was like they were all characters that, you know.
And they were laughing.
And Pence. And,
yeah. Ugh. Yeah.
I mean, these people are just.
He's playing the media. Think about this, right? His show had the first popular villain, Omarosa. Right,
mm-hmm.
And if you look at Stephen Colbert versus Jon Stewart, Stephen Colbert was loved by both sides.
Well, the other side didn't know he was a put on.
They didn't know he was sarcastic. He didn't get sarcasm.
That's why I stopped doing the Colbert thing. Go ahead.
So I think that's what Trump's doing, right? He's when it comes to things that are really divide. He's basically a leader based on perception, not reality.
Right.
He never wants to be the messenger. He's turning this into a popularity contest by any means necessary.
Yeah.
He doesn't care if it kills people. He doesn't care if it hurts people. So he's now what he's doing is he's separating himself from government. So he's saying, hey, I'm for torture, but I'm going to defer to Mills, and he's against it.
Right.
So now it's like, well, wait, well, what is the White House stance? I'm Stephen Colbert now. I'm speaking to both sides.
Right.
Right. And same with this abortion stuff. I'm going to have Pence speak to it. Oh, but I myself. And now you've got all these people saying, oh, well, Trump's not really for abortion, but he's allowing it to happen. He's allowing the end of Roe v. Wade, which is archaic. And he's playing us because he's too cowardly to have an opinion.
Right. You know, I was doing Colbert before Colbert was doing Colbert. And I was, John wanted me to work for Steve. And I wanted to, but it was a non-union gig at the time, so I couldn't do it. And I stopped doing the Colbert thing in the early 90s, where I was just coming on stage and playing the conservative because I began to notice that I was playing clubs that were all right-wing.
Wow.
And they thought I was serious. I was doing jokes like, you know, we got to get, you know, hell with the planet, forest fires. We got to cut down trees. Trees are the number one cause of forest fires.
Yeah, they ruin your golf game.
Yeah, I mean, and I get these big laughs, and I thought, oh my God, they think I'm serious.
Yeah.
And you know, Colbert is much more talented than I am and much smarter.
I'm a pretty big fan of yours.
Well, this is what I remember, and this is why I stopped doing the satire. And then I had a flashback yesterday when we were on SiriusXM, so I want to share this with you. I remember listening to Rush Limbaugh, in 1991. I used to listen to him when he started because I was living in San Francisco and he used to be on in Sacramento. Mm-hmm. Nobody knew who he was. And then my dad began listening to him in New York City and said, I love this guy. He's a carnival barker. He's an idiot. He's yeah. funny. He's so outrageous. You know, nobody takes him seriously. Yeah. And he hid behind comedy, Rush Limbaugh. He always said, I'm a comedian. I'm not really fun. I'm trying to be funny here. And I remember driving to Los Angeles from San Francisco on Highway 5 the day Shock and Awe started in 1991 when we started bombing Iraq. Mm. And I tuned in to hear Rush Limbaugh because I thought, okay, you got your war, Rush.
Yeah.
We're bombing Iraq. It's 1991. Let's hear it. And he took the day off.
Jesus.
He took the day off the day we went to war in Iraq. He had been beating the drum and been funny, and then yeah. he took it off. And I went, I am not going to pretend to be a conservative anymore
yeah.
because these guys are cowards and their audiences are so stupid
yeah.
that they think I'm serious. And I just, yeah. morally, I couldn't do it yeah. anymore. I couldn't do it.
Well, I have a ton of respect for you for doing that because money is a tough thing to give up.
So here's I had a flashback. Well, I wasn't making that much money. It was 19, you know, come on. I wasn't successful at it. But here's what I had a flashback yesterday. We were doing John Fugelsang's show
yeah.
over at SiriusXM. I love John. Is
me too. He's great.
He's the best and so yeah. brave. I had this idea that I wanted to go after ExxonMobil because mm-hmm. ExxonMobil is the devil. They have installed Trump. They've populated the cabinet with yeah. operatives.
Oil men, yeah.
They knew that they were going to raise the Earth's temperature by 5 degrees. They yeah. hid the evidence and just called it a mild clerical error. I thought, well, here I am. I'm going to the 40th floor at the McGraw-Hill building, SiriusXM. I cannot call for a boycott of ExxonMobil because John has sponsors. You cannot you can't go after the corporations, right?
Yeah.
So what I did is I said, I just want to say this boycott of ExxonMobil is wrong. Do you remember I said that?
I do.
I said, you know, we cannot allow this boycott of ExxonMobil. Yes, they did know that they were raising the temperature by 5 degrees,
yeah.
but that was a clerical error. So I turned it into a joke, and I thought, oh, that's what satire is.
Yeah.
Where you say the opposite yeah. because you're not allowed to say the truth.
Exactly. You know who invented that?
Jonathan Swift.
Well, there is a book called Hip, The History, and it was about black people. And when they were enslaved, they said, where did cool come from? And he talked about when black people were enslaved, there's one time that the white master would allow black people to lead. It was when they were in church. And they let the black priest speak to the black congregation. So they started using language to confuse the white master. So if a guy tried to run away, he'd be like, y'all saw that Jimmy ran away. He's one bad man.
Really?
So the white guy would hear him say bad man, but the congregation understood that bad meant good. And then later on, when black people came free, this other skill set they had was music. So they go to blues clubs and jazz uh-huh. clubs, and then the Hep Cats came, and they started learning the language. That's where cool came from. So this opposite language and what you're doing now, it also comes from people that are trying to fight back. It's fighting language. It's revolutionary language.
To say the opposite.
Absolutely, yeah. To exclude them, to be able to speak. You know, it's just like capoeira. So it looks like they're dancing, but really they're fighting to confuse the overlords. Uh-huh. So absolutely, yeah. I think that language has roots and it has great history.
I wasn't even aware of what I was. It
was beautiful that you did it naturally, organically.
I thought, oh, that's what I was doing.
Yeah. I smiled when you did it because that's the first thing I thought of. I was like, bravo.
I forgot how to do that.
Yeah.
Hey, Tamer Kattan, we're going to wrap it up. Will you come back?
Of course, I'd love to be back.
We have a lot of show today. You're going to be at Gandhi, Is That You?
Yeah.
February 8th.
And how do you confuse Gandhi? Was it Prince in a poncho? Of course it's Gandhi. Gandhi, Is That You? A brown, tiny guy.
Speaking of passive resistance, that's yeah. that's the
Amen.
Way to fight.
Absolutely. Especially now.
Study Gandhi. Don't punch Nazis.
Yeah, you're right.
Study Gandhi. Lucky Jack Bar on Orchard Street, February 8th. I'm going to be there February 3rd, right, Alex?
February 3rd.
February 1st.
I'll come see you.
You are the winner of the World Series of Comedy 2015. You won the Ginger Award, even though you're not a redhead, in 2014 for Best New International Act at the Edinburgh Festival. Hey, we're all out of time. I have one final question.
Yes, sir.
Your dad is a Muslim.
Yes, sir.
Your mother's a Jew.
Yep.
What do you think of the Muslim ban?
I think it's
We're
terrible.
All out of time. Thank you, Tamer. We'll talk to you next time. Hey, that's our show. I'm not going to apologize for the length, but I will for the girth. Sorry. Come on. What am I going to do? We worked hard this week, and we're going to keep working hard for you. This is going to be America's finest moment, I promise you. Think Apollo 13. Think of Apollo 13, how great America felt bringing those three astronauts home. We are going to save our republic, and we will remember it this time. We'll remember what happens. This is going to be a cautionary tale of how democracy almost slipped through our hands because of peak TV, because we were so busy watching so much television, we forgot to pick up a newspaper and read it. Help me out. The best way to help me out is by becoming a monthly subscriber for $5 a month. That will just improve the show because I can't hire interns. I have to pay people, or I have to do all the work myself. If you don't have money and you have time, contact me. There are things that we can do that you can help with the show. I've been crowdsourcing some research on Twitter and Facebook, so thank you for that. And I answer all my emails, do all your Amazon shopping via the David Feldman Show website. It helps. We get a small percentage. It helps. Subscribe on iTunes. Give us a good review on iTunes. Thank you for that. There's some of you people have been giving me good reviews on iTunes. That helps. Subscribe on Stitcher. Give me a good review on Stitcher. Subscribe on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel that I'm trying to grow. If you subscribe to the YouTube channel, it's a great way to then take the videos, copy and paste those links, and then post them on Facebook, post them on Twitter. Spread the links on all your social media. Stumble upon, dig. Facebook, Twitter. I don't understand Reddit. I've tried to go into Reddit. I spend all my time on Facebook and Twitter when I do my social media. If somebody understands Reddit and wants to help out and post links and talk about this show on Reddit, I'm all ears. I just don't understand how Reddit works. Okay, we got a lot of work to do from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.